I'm going to be keeping you company for the next few hours.
You are not going to believe the company.
This company.
You're going to bankrupt your mama's company.
At least I have the radio to keep me company.
On 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
So let me tell you, like, a thing about growing up on the north side of Indianapolis, and just in Indianapolis in general, okay? There were so many great things about growing up in Indy. And, you know, for me, growing up, the going to school all the way through with the same group of kids and the same group of friends, and of the people that I grew up with, the majority went to IU or Purdue. A handful of kids went to Ball State. I knew some kids that went to Indiana State as well. My great aunt had gone to Indiana State Teachers College, which of course became Indiana State University. And I had family from Terre Haute, and my Aunt Dottie would talk to me all the time when I was a kid about maybe I should go to Indiana State. And I'll be honest, I kind of had this like arrogance about Indiana State. Like, nah, I'm going to go to IU probably, like Indiana State, I don't know. And then as I went through the age of college and then into young adulthood, I got to know different people who had gone to Indiana State, and I always felt bad. And this is going to sound so arrogant to say, but I always felt kind of bad because I really felt for the fact that it felt like the people that I knew that went to Indiana State had a great pride about being graduates or products of Indiana State, but at the same time were a little bit reserved and not as vociferous about that pride as people that went to Indiana, Purdue, or Ball State, almost like they had an insecurity that they were not from one of those three schools. And I think some of that's based in NCAA tournament runs and, you know, football and everything else. And just the fact that there's a smaller alumni base for Indiana State. But I always felt kind of bad for Indiana State, to be honest with you, because it felt like some of the people that went to school there were denied the opportunity on the biggest of stages to brag on their school. And so that's why a couple of years ago, Jimmy, do you remember a clothing store called Stephen Barry's? It was big for like 36 months.
Vaguely, yeah.
And they would sell sweatshirts for like $8. And so I went into a Stephen Barry's once and I bought an Indiana State sweatshirt because I'm like, you know, I kind of feel sorry for Indiana State. Like, they need fans, you know? And so I bought one and I would wear it and people would come up to me like, oh, did you go to ISU? So I knew that people that went to ISU felt this great fraternal feeling about going to ISU. But they didn't have the mountaintops to scream from like IU fans did during March or Purdue fans do when they're a number one seed or even Ball State fans with Letterman and whatever else. You had Larry Bird for sure. But so with all of that said, like, I just want to give, as the kids say, a shout out to Indiana State. Like, this is your time. This is your moment. It's your day. Indiana State is the story right now. Purdue, we're going to talk plenty about, and for good reason, in the NCAA tournament today. But Indiana State last night was fun to watch. It was a great game. Edgerrin James's kid is good, by the way. And the Sycamores roar their way now into the NIT semifinals, proving to the entire college basketball world that they got totally screwed by the NCAA committee. And I bought tickets Tuesday night. I called JMV, and I'm like, look, if you can't get them, like, the two of us will go. If not, Shannon will go, whatever. But, like, I'm all in. I got my Sycamore shorts on. And look, you can call me a bandwagoner. You can call me a front runner. I don't care. Whatever. I'm all in. Like, get the champagne velvet. Let's go. Go Trees, Terre Haute. I'm all in. Right? Vigo in some language somewhere must mean large because we're living large today, baby. I'm all in on the Trees.
No, there's nothing wrong with that. I wouldn't label you as a front runner for doing that. I would label you as somebody that is empowering or further supporting a community that deserves it, right? I mean, I have that same vibe as you did, Jake, where it was like there is that sense of hesitance or anxiety from friends of mine that went there because oftentimes there's a boisterous level of personality that comes with going to an IU, a Purdue, a Notre Dame, a Butler, a Ball State, like you mentioned, and I said it when I was calling you guys from Vegas last week. I know you guys said it on the show as well. The committee probably doesn't care, and we have this conversation yearly where you gripe about the bubble after Selection Sunday a couple days, and then it fades away and it leaves the national conversation. But if nothing else, this is a campaign and maybe double birds from Indiana State to the committee saying, hey, you didn't put us in your tournament. Maybe we wouldn't have made it all the way to your Final Four, but we're going to the NIT's Final Four, and we have a real shot to win the whole thing.
The beauty of it is you don't hear this national argument being made about Virginia Commonwealth or being made about Utah that are the other two that are playing in it. You know, the national standpoint, I mean, this is a team that's won 31 games, right? So everybody's on board.
And they checked all, like, net, everything that they were told matters. They checked
that's
every
exactly
box.
Correct.
They still didn't get in.
And then, you know, everybody's like, well, the Big 12 had a great year. Fine. Big 12's going home. Cincinnati, right down 74, right? Indiana State. Take 70 to 74 and get on out. Edgerrin James's kid is good, by the way, if I didn't mention. How are you today, by the way? Is today Wednesday, Jimmy?
It is Wednesday. It's hump day.
Hump day Wednesday. My name is Jake Query. That is the voice of Jimmy Cook. Eddie Garrison here as well. We have a new employee to the company, Jimmy. Did you hear?
I did hear.
We have a new employee to the company. His name is Steve Wagner, and he is actually the official, we're just going to say, legal analyst for the program, for the company? Is that cool, Steve?
That'll work, yes.
So you're an attorney, is that right? I know that you are with, I'm assuming, because you come to us from Wagner Reese Law Firm, I assume that means that you are an attorney, right?
I am, yes. And what, certified.
What form of law?
The worst type.
Okay, so if I just want to sue anybody, you're my guy? Or are you my guy if I'm getting sued?
No, I'm your guy. If something bad happens, really bad, and somebody needs to be held accountable, I will pull the trigger and sue the hell out of them.
Okay, good. So you're not coming after me to be held accountable. I've never been held accountable for anything in my life, Steve. I know.
No, you're...
We talking like Med Mal, Steve? What are we talking about?
We're talking... Well, if I get pulled over by IMPD anywhere in town, I'm in trouble. I'll put it that way.
Okay. So
they step outside the bounds and accidentally kill somebody, I get involved.
All right.
Explosions, sex abuse, all that happy stuff.
Okay. So Steve is with Wagner Reese Law Firm and actually is here on a serious note because you were part of a fundraiser. Blue Hope, is that correct? Am I saying
Blue
that correct?
Blue Hope Bash, correct.
The Blue Hope Bash. And this raised money to help fight against colorectal cancer. And you said, you know what, I've listened to that show, the knob on your radio clearly is broken, so you knew of this radio station, and you said, I'll come in and play around and have fun for 3 hours today. And so I figured in looking at your bio and seeing that you went to Notre Dame, correct?
I did.
So Jimmy's with you on that.
Go Irish.
And then you also went to Brebeuf, right?
I did.
So that means that you went to school with Jeff Moe, is that correct?
Yeah, he was leaving right when I was coming in, but Alan Henderson, time period, yeah.
Okay, so you would have bridged the two of them, right?
Yep.
Okay, so I figured we're going to do nothing today but talk basically 90s Brebeuf basketball and then Notre Dame glory football. How's that?
That sounds like a fantastic 3 hours listeners.
And then you went to IU for law school, so we can mix in IU's glory days as well, right?
Yeah, I bounced back and forth between Notre Dame football and IU basketball for many years. Now I only have one out of the two.
So you're a reversible jacket guy.
Hey, exactly. That's all right. My man. Man after my own heart right there. Love that.
Jimmy, this is basically the established and professionally educated version of yourself,
correct,
right?
It is, yes, yeah.
That's essentially what we're looking
at. Not to fully insult Steve there, but yeah, the professional side, that's key. It's carrying a lot of weight.
There's a lot to talk about today, by the way. Jeremiah Johnson from Pacers Radio is going to join us on the program. So too, Robbie Hummel, who, of course, will help us break down the NCAA tournament as we are in the Sweet 16. We might even ask Hummel about Indiana State, right? They deserve to be in the NCAA conversation at this point. And then Brad Miller, former Purdue Boilermaker and Indiana Pacer All-Star, going to join us at 2 o'clock. Brad is living out in California. My understanding, he's got like 75 acres outside of Sacramento. So life's good for Brad Miller. So he's going to join us as well today. Steve, I will begin by asking you this. Did you watch last night, not to put you on the spot, but did you watch any of the Indiana State game? Because you and I were talking about it a little bit before we got on the air.
I was en route back from vacation, so I wasn't able to watch, but I was keeping an eye on the ticker and certainly rooting for the Sycamores.
I mean, here's the thing about them. They just offensively, you know, and this is what is so, and I hate to, again, I'm going to violate my own policy here because I'm going to talk about Indiana State by incorporating Indiana, for example, which has to drive Sycamore fans crazy, but...
Not as much as it drives Purdue fans crazy. So that you got
is correct. There's probably some crossover as well, right, between the fan bases.
Doubt.
But it is amazing that in today's era of college basketball, that there would be programs that have no outside shooters when you get a team like Indiana State that has essentially... four outside shooters and then one guy that perfectly facilitates all of it from the post or from the high post that also himself can shoot. And the reality is that when you get, Jimmy, teams that can shoot the basketball and at any time a barrage can come. They were down 5-7 for the vast majority of that second half until all of a sudden the shots started dropping, and when they jumped out with about 7 minutes to go into a 5-point lead and then extended that, at that point it was over for Cincinnati, right?
Yeah, and that's part of the reason that, again, not to dwell on it, but I wanted, like many, to see them part of the NCAA tournament field, because they're a team that, yeah, maybe they get down 4, 5, 6, 7 points at any given time during a game, but their offense is so fluid and so explosive that they're able to make up those deficits. I know JMV has joked a time or two that it felt like throughout the regular season there were moments where they could not get stops. They were more of an offensive-oriented team, but they were able to get stops when it mattered late last night. So, yeah, they're as fun a team as anybody in college basketball. That's part of the reason they were ranked so highly in every important metric going into Selection Sunday. And I appreciate this thought of the state itself, regardless of who your alma mater or real school you root for, acknowledging that, yes, it's a missed opportunity, but it's not a missed opportunity to miss the NCAA tournament and then go by the wayside quietly. Go win the whole thing now. Like, now you have home state advantage. It's not that far of a drive to get to Hinkle Fieldhouse. I know that, at least from the press releases from Indiana State side, there's not going to be true fan blocks, but go buy the hell out of these tickets.
Hey, let me tell you something. I told Steve this. Steve, when I was going over for you my ticket situation, did you consider me a venture capitalist at that point? Did you think to yourself, no, this is a sharp guy?
You were definitely weighing the economic benefits versus the emotional support for the western part of the state.
Okay, so here's what happened, Jimmy.
All right.
So last night, there's like 2 minutes to go in the game, and I think this will be fun. I want to go to Hinkle. And I say to Shannon, I go, Shannon, I'm thinking about buying tickets to go to Hinkle on Tuesday night. Do you want to go? And I look over, and she's dead asleep. And I thought, well, okay, there's the go-ahead. So I get online, and I go first off to the primary source, and tickets were not yet available. Now, I don't know how this is possible, but if they're not available yet from the primary source, I'm not giving any names here, then you go to the secondary market, and they're all available, okay?
Sure.
So I go on the secondary market, I get on the website, and I see very good seats at Hinkle in the lower level along the baseline for really reasonable price.
Did this secondary market site have fees or no?
Yes.
Okay.
So I'm like, oh, I'm in. This is very, very reasonable. I'm in. So I click on it. I've got them. I'm in the queue. It's, you know, you have 10 minutes to purchase these tickets, right? So then I hit it, and it's like, you must log in. Well, now I forget my login password. Now, Steve, you are of the same age range as I, right?
Close, yeah.
You have how many login passwords, would you say, in your phone? How many, what are we talking, 25, 30?
25, 30, yeah.
Okay. How many of them do you remember off the top of your head without having to go into your phone or somewhere to look them up?
Zero.
That's exactly right? So you were well aware of the predicament that was falling upon me. And then the pressure, right? The pressure was mounting, and I'm like, oh my gosh, the clock's ticking. So I find my password, I log it in, and I'm thinking it's going to continue with the same purchase. Well, in that amount of time, those tickets have now been sold, and the game has ended. So those tickets that were now like four times that price.
Yep.
So I find 200-level tickets, very reasonable, and I buy them. I buy two of them, right? So I call JMV, and I'm like, hey, I have two tickets. I think Shannon and I are going to go. You see if you can get tickets. We'll all go together, whatever. If you can't find them, then you and I can go, and I'll tell Shannon that, you know, she can watch more Real Housewives that night. So JMV last night calls me and goes, dude, those tickets sold out in like 24 minutes. So now the tickets that I had have already like tripled in price. So now I'm thinking to myself, do I go ahead and buy them now for the championship game and then run the risk of you know, Indiana State losing? But if they win, voila, now I'm sitting on a gold mine. Now, Steve, you obviously are a finely educated person. Your thought is that I do what?
Well, I think you should go ahead and buy them now and donate them to the Colorectal Cancer Institute.
That's an excellent idea. That's an excellent idea, actually.
Great,
right?
Idea.
For the finals, right?
For the finals, yes. Yes. No, I mean, you're in a tough position. I mean, you know, that price is going to keep going up, Jake, and you put it out there now for everybody to know that you're either going to sell off and now, take the easy cash.
Now everybody's doing the same thing, right? Darn it. I should have thought about this. I didn't see, Steve, this is the problem. I don't I'm not what they say somebody who thinks things through, right? It's a bit of an issue, which is probably why it's good the two of us are meeting today, considering your line of work, right?
So I think you need a legal analyst here most of the time to probably keep you in track is what you need.
You have an open door invitation. So we now, we are going on Tuesday. So I think it's probably going to be John and I are going on Tuesday. And, you know, I want to know from Indiana State fans, do you are they cool with me joining on the bandwagon here, or are they like stay in your lane?
What time is the game, by the way?
Well, that's their two. That's the other thing. Thank you for asking.
Because I'm looking online and I want to, that could be a placeholder time.
Now, what do you mean by that?
Well, like on one of the sites, to not name it, it says, and this can't be right. It has to be a typo. I mean, my time zone's wrong. It says 1 o'clock. But that can't be right. There's no way you're having an NIT semifinal at 1. It's got to be a nighttime event.
Well, it's a doubleheader. I think it's at 7 o'clock, isn't it?
Yeah, no, like I said, I think it's just my – that's why I'm asking you, have you checked it?
Well,
it's definitely not at 1 o'clock. It's for sure in the evening.
I would assume it's in the evening, but I looked that is also a very good question because when I looked, it only showed the semifinals. I'm hoping I bought – can you imagine, Steve, wouldn't this be my luck if I'm like, you know what, I've got the best seat available for Georgia versus who's the other semifinal? I don't even know.
It depends on who wins between Seton Hall and UNLV and then VCU, Utah.
Yeah, so can you imagine if I end up with great seats for Georgia, Seton Hall?
Resale value not real high.
There's not a lot of people coming from New Jersey or Athens or even like if Vegas gets in.
Must be a placeholder time because it says for the final at 7 o'clock, so I would assume it's an evening.
Well, the semifinal on Tuesday, it's got to be a doubleheader. I would assume a 7 o'clock and a 9 o'clock.
Yeah, that'd be my guess.
My assumption is that the ticket I bought is for both sessions. Is that a dangerous assumption?
Well, it should say it. I would go back and look at your ticket. It should say all sessions or say session one or session two.
These are the kind of things we've
got some info for the both of you on this this regard.
All right, what do you got?
ESPN will make the decision tomorrow morning as to when that game will be played.
Yeah.
But it will be 7 or 9:30.
There you go.
Most likely.
Thank you, Eddie.
The ticket I have simply says NIT semifinals.
I would say all sessions then. That would be my lean.
It does say, the ticket says Georgia versus TBD or Indiana State versus TBD.
Yeah, I would say all sessions then, based on that.
Now, that TBD is pretty good, by the way. Those guys are tough.
they had some quad one wins.
I don't know if you know this or not, but TBD's got six players in the transfer portal, and Mike Woodson's confident they're going to reload them next year, right? That's the way that's going to work out.
Yep.
Pacers are, what, they got one left, Eddie, in Chicago on their road trip?
Yes, sir.
That game is when?
8 o'clock tonight. Pregame on the Fan will start at 7:30 with Pat Boylan and the Kroger pregame show. And Mark Boyle and Eddie Gill will be on the call as well. Then you have the world's greatest postgame show after the conclusion of the game with Eddie White.
Do we know that that's the world's greatest postgame show?
Yeah, 100%.
They've done studies. Yeah.
Have we done full assessment of postgame shows from like Bangladesh and things like that?
How many postgame shows have two Eddies? That's the real sticking point.
Focus groups are really big on the two Eddies.
Actually,
they've said
three,
that kind of carries
the
load.
Board, right?
Well, the postgame show only has two.
So it's you and Eddie White.
Correct.
Eddie Gill doesn't ever come on?
No, because he does TV postgame with Jeremiah Johnson.
He never once has come on that?
No.
Why?
Because he does postgame with Jeremiah Johnson.
But it's not the whole time. You guys stay on for like 3.5 hours.
That is
true. Have you ever heard Eddie White talk?
Yes. I listen to him every night. There's a Pacers game, yeah.
Brevity, not necessarily a strong suit.
There's only like 9 games left.
I know. Steve, you a Pacer fan?
Huge.
When you were growing up in Indianapolis, did you go to Market Square Arena during the Brown Curtain days?
Oh, yeah.
Your favorite Pacer then was who?
So this is before they got good, right? So
yes,
yeah,
correct.
This is the really old days.
The Jose Slaughter era.
Yeah, that's Terrence Stansberry.
Yeah, oh, yeah. Statue of Liberty dunk.
Yeah, he had a very brief but buoyant career.
He did. That's a very good way of saying it. I just remember, and I think, you know, a lot of people don't realize this. I mean, it was such a surreal thing when they did break through in the late night or in the mid 90s because, I mean, you know what it was like. You'd go down and buy tickets for $9 and move down, and before you know it, you're in the front 20 rows, and they had the brown curtain that was pulled around, and then you'd stay afterwards to see Kool and the Gang because that was the entire enticement for you to go to the concert, to go to the game, right?
The highlight was Dancing Harry.
Oh, yeah. Dancing Harry was a huge deal. Dancing Harry, as I understand it, 5 or 10 years ago. I think he's still with us, but he eventually, if I'm not mistaken, the last that he was, you know, found, if you will, he was working as a curbside guy at the airport in Denver, like a baggage guy. You know what I mean? Like you go and you, what do you call those guys that you check, that check in your bag?
Right.
Baggage check guy.
Yep.
In the Denver airport, and somebody's like, wait a minute, aren't you dancing, Harry? I don't know if he still dances when he takes your bags in. But, you know, in those days, and I've always said this, I feel like in sports, regardless of our age or our fandom or whatever else, a large part of sports is like chasing the high of the first time that you fell in love with a team and saw them break through. And there was such a magic to those Pacer teams that, pardon the pun, beat the Magic for an NBA playoff victory and made the run to the Eastern Conference Finals, because for guys like me and you in our era that had seen so many bad teams, and the idea of them being good was a fictional story. So to see it happening before us, now you're wanting them to again recapture that so that you can chase that same high. Does that make sense?
We want Byron Scott hitting a shot from the corner to beat Orlando.
That's exactly right. That is exactly right. That is exactly right. They swept the Magic, right?
Yeah.
It's awesome. And then in those days, you were coaching tennis, is that right?
Yeah, for years and years at North Central. I taught there in the summers and got sunburned.
Now, that was Barbara Wynn that was in charge of that, right? Does tennis in Indianapolis, you know, you had obviously the RCA championships, the clay courts before that. Tennis was a pretty viable part of the sports community in this town. And I don't know, because I'm not in that element anymore, but I knew what it meant to people on the north side of Indianapolis in the early to mid-80s. Is that still as present in terms of the tennis culture in the state?
You know, that's one of the big losses we've had in sports. And we had so many gains, you know, the amateur sports capital of the world, and obviously our professional teams. But losing an ATP tournament basically to Cincinnati was a huge thing. And I think it did hurt the Indianapolis tennis community before the scourge of pickleball.
Do you play pickleball?
You said scourge.
Yeah. I do when my wife can drag me
out
there.
Our boss is the biggest pickleball maniac on the planet. Like, as a matter of fact, you might get hired literally as not only just the legal analyst of the company, but just as a third part of the show here, once he hears your, if you're into pickleball, or you can coach pickleball, or you can teach pickleball.
Well, but are you anti-pickleball?
I'm more anti. Okay, yeah, I had a topspin baseline game that just does not translate to the small pickleball
court. Well, the
problem
is the number of pickleball players that think it does, right? Like, there's guys at my gym, there's a guy that was like, hey, you want to play pickleball? And I'm like, sure, I don't know what I'm doing exactly. And literally, this guy thought it was 80 and he's Bjorn Borg, right? And he's like, he's yelling at me.
Standing 10 feet behind the baseline. Just...
Yeah, I mean, he's getting way into it, and he's pointing me out and screaming at me on where I'm supposed to be. And I'm like, I don't really understand the kitchen thing. I don't know when you're supposed to go in it and when you're supposed to go out of it. It's very confusing to me.
A lot of rules.
But is there a chance that can pickleball reinvigorate American interest in tennis, or are they rivals of one another? Does that make sense?
I think they're rivals, because a lot of those people that would be playing USTA team tennis are switching over. You know, they think it less chance they're going to blow their knee out. It's more social. You can play co-ed. So you're just, a lot of those people that might go out there and play tennis are now playing pickleball.
There are a few things, though, to me, Steve, and I've said this before on the air, I don't know that there's any sport that can be more captivating to watch very close, like in a front five rows, than high level tennis. It is the hand eye coordination, the ball placement, and the movement of the athletes is absolutely breathtaking. It's unbelievable. And you don't, and listen, I'm not even talking about watching it at the college or the high school level, which there are obviously very, very good players. I grew up with some of them. But when you go and you watch, I went to the, you know, watching at the RCAs and seeing Sampras and Roddick and watching the return of serves and the speed of serves, Greg Rusedski serving the ball. I mean, it's unbelievable to watch that. And it was such a huge part of our culture, Wimbledon and the U.S. Open in the 80s. It was great, right?
We had the best players in the world come here. I remember seeing McEnroe when they used to play the clay courts at IRC on Dean Road. My dad took me there when I was a little kid, and late night, probably till 11:30 at night, watching John McEnroe with the hair, the fro, and the headband play. It was unbelievable.
Some canvas Stan Smiths running around.
Yeah,
it's the best. And then, you know, they moved it obviously to Clay. Mats Wilander was really good. I mean, there's some good players that came through here for sure.
Jake, well, I think we might have some breaking news on the table.
Do we have the sounder there, Eddie?
Eddie, I'll let you take care of it.
Per Jeff Goodman, Louisville is closing in on a deal of College of Charleston's Pat Kelsey to be their next basketball coach for the Cardinals.
If you're Louisville, it's interesting. And there are a couple of ways you can look at that. And I'll explain exactly what I mean by that in terms of what that means for Louisville and how it kind of relates locally. We'll get to that. We'll continue talking Pacers and NCAA tournament. Loaded show on a hump day Wednesday. Thanks for tuning in. It's Query and Company here on 93.5, 107.5 The Fan.
Did you know that April is Foot Health Awareness?
So if you're just joining us, where have you been? Steve Wagner is joining us in studio, part of a fundraiser for colorectal cancer research and trying to end that, obviously, horrific and dreaded disease. But the big news, the breaking news, Jimmy, go ahead and give it to me one more time and what just came down in the world of college basketball.
So we have had a new wrinkle to this in the last 5 minutes, but the original breaking news was from Jeff Goodman at Goodman Hoops. Louisville is closing in on a deal with College of Charleston's Pat Kelsey that would make Kelsey the Cardinals head coach, sources told at the Field of 68. That was at 12:04. 6 minutes ago, Matt Norlander of CBS clarified things further, saying on Twitter, here's what I have on Louisville per sources. Pat Kelsey has not agreed to become U of L's next coach, nor has he signed any papers, nor has there been a verbal promise to Kelsey to be the next coach. Could get there fast, but as of this moment, U of L Kelsey do not have a deal. So not fully necessarily contradicting Jeff Goodman, but just clarifying out there from Matt Norlander, who's another respected journalist within college basketball. Nothing is official yet, but it could be trending that way, that it is going to be Pat Kelsey of the College of Charleston to be the next Louisville head coach. But nothing signed, nothing agreed to.
Here's what is, I guess, for any school in Indiana, Purdue, Indiana State, who may be entering into this arena very shortly. Louisville's a mystery to me, because Louisville is a job that, and I think that we have the ability to think inside of our own snow globe and our own echo chamber. For example, Steve, if I were to ask you to name the six biggest programs in college basketball, just all time, off the top of your head, you would say what?
North Carolina, Kentucky, Arizona, Duke.
Duke for sure. Probably Indiana.
IU. IU'd be on that
Kansas,
list.
And then Kansas. I mean, yeah. Louisville's
UCLA,
right.
UCLA probably,
UCLA,
right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And Louisville's right in the mix, right? Like you think of Louisville in that mix. But what we forget with Louisville, and Louisville obviously had history before Denny Crum got there, don't get me wrong, but you know, Denny Crum was a huge part of that, and then obviously with Patino carrying on. But Louisville is a very proud, certainly of the last 40 years, an extremely proud program that has been in the upper, I don't know if it's ever top five, but top 5 to 10 in terms of its prestige, right? And yet, for whatever reason, Louisville felt like when they had a head coaching opening, they had to stick with somebody that was like within the family, that everybody knew. And then they probably rode that a little bit too long. And then they were kind of desperately searching to fill that void. And for whatever reason, they haven't been able. You would think that people would be lining up to coach at Louisville. And this feels, Jimmy, does it not, kind of like a shoe carnival?
Yeah.
I mean, like they can't. It's taken forever. And there's a name for 2 weeks. And then, no, actually, it's this name. And then Dusty May was going to go there, but no, actually, he supposedly was threatened. No, he wasn't. A coach made that up that's on the radio, and then he's going to go to Michigan instead, and then maybe they'll get the guy from Indiana State, but he might go to St. Louis. And it's Louisville, right? So my point being, for fans, and I know there were fans for Purdue, and this is ludicrous to think, but there were Purdue fans a couple of years ago that were like, Purdue's got to move on from Matt Painter. You know, these tournament disappointments, Purdue's got to work on, they got to run on from Matt Painter. And I'm like, look, it's not that easy. Indiana's been chasing the high for 20 years now, right?
Yeah.
I mean,
and also on Louisville's searching front, Jake, I don't know if this is a wake-up call for Louisville or if it's a wake-up call for all of college basketball. I don't have this like as sourced, but the rumor mill was they wanted to try to go get a big name. They probably liked the rumor mill when Indiana job was thought to be open. I'm sure they called Scott Drew. He's one of the most popular names in college basketball. If they did have that conversation, which again, I can't source that. I'm not saying they did, but if they did go try to get a big fish and they were denied, that's one avenue where it's like, okay, maybe Louisville is not viewed by some of these other coaches as a better opportunity than a Big 12 school. And then secondly, what we talked about yesterday, I think that Louisville kind of got caught with their pants down when Dusty May, for whatever reason, was thought to be the guy going to Louisville, and then in a span of 24 hours, no, actually, he's going to Michigan. So I'm not saying this is a full pivot, but what this would be for Pat Kelsey is the natural progression of what a coaching ladder is supposed to be. You do really well at a mid-major. He's taken a tournament team for the last 5 years, whether it's at Winthrop or back-to-back years at College of Charleston, and now he's taking the next big leap to a real Power 5 job that is in need of a lot of rebranding and a new foundation being laid to try to get back to where they've been in the past.
So he's won. Charleston, though, to me, like you look at Winthrop, he wins 66% of his games, right? And then at Charleston in 3 years, he's 75-27 and done a remarkable job. I remember there was a guy at Charleston named John Kress. I don't think anybody remembers John Kress. But John Kress, when he was at Charleston, won like 84% of his games over 30 years. I mean, it was unbelievable. And I remember thinking, like, you know, in today's day, John Kress, because that's flavor of the month, right? John Kress in today's day probably would have been like hired by Clemson or South Carolina like within 5 years. What I wonder about with Charleston is Charleston the new Dayton or Virginia Commonwealth where like everybody wins there and the numbers get a little bit misleading?
See, here's my thing. Because I thought about that too. I wonder if that's just exclusively an Archie thing. Because when you think about the new VCU, I know it's just the small sample size, but the guy that left there wound up doing pretty good. Shaka Smart is an elite coach in college basketball, right? Archie is the one name that you look at of a school of that caliber of Dayton, and then you see the winning happen after he left, and it's like, maybe it was just him. Like, I get that same fear that you're saying, like, oh, well, is College of Charleston a place where anybody can win at? I mean, from an NCAA tournament appearance standpoint, they had not been to the dance since, I guess they made it in 2018, and then they've gone back-to-back appearances since, but prior to that, it had been since the 90s they'd been to the dance. Dayton, I've always kind of thought as a perennial mid-major that's always going to be in that conversation. I think that might just have been an Archie thing. Because then you look at him at Rhode Island, and
right,
they're just a mess.
Total
an absolute mess,
right?
Losing as a 12 seed in the first round of the A-10.
Steve Wagner, by the way, joins us in studio as well. That all part of a charity fundraiser for the Blue Hope Bash to fight against colorectal cancer. Steve, you did graduate work at, or you did undergrad or graduate at Notre Dame?
Undergrad.
Okay, so do you still follow Notre Dame in basketball?
Not as much, no.
Because it does feel like, you know, I thought Mike Bray was a really good coach, but there are times with coaches where once, I hate to say once it's over, it's over. Like, he kind of knew, I think, that it was time to move on and the shelf life was there, but they go and they get Michael Shrewsbury, who things appear to be pointed in the right direction. You then did your graduate work at Indiana. Did you grow up an Indiana fan, you said?
I was actually a Purdue fan growing up.
Okay, so are you fired up about the Boilers now?
I am.
You worried about Gonzaga?
Yeah, I mean, they're a great team, and they can get hot. And but, I mean, this is a different Purdue team this year. It really seems like it's a different team. Braden Smith's unbelievable.
He is very, very good. I think, let me ask you this, as a Purdue fan, does it worry you, and I know this is going to sound crazy, does it worry you that Purdue beat Gonzaga by double digits earlier this year? Because I think it's a different Gonzaga team.
I think you just throw that out. I really do. I mean, that was early in the year, different teams, preseason tournament. It's going to be a hell of a game. It really is.
I mean, Jake, I don't know
that it's going to matter, but if I'm a Purdue fan, I don't like the fact that much like you get the advantage of playing a team twice in conference, that Gonzaga has seen that, even though it was very early in the season, they've seen Zach Edey. They've seen this Purdue. I don't like the idea of having previous scout to go off of. I don't think it's going to make a difference. I think Purdue's going to win the game still, but that would worry me a little bit getting a second bite at the apple against them.
But it does feel like since that first meeting that of the two teams, and this is a credit to Purdue, I talked about this before, that Purdue was closer to their ceiling in that first go-round than was Gonzaga. Gonzaga had more room for growth, and to Gonzaga's credit, they have made that growth.
If you're
right?
looking at a chart, Purdue was closer to 100 all year. Gonzaga went down to like the 30s
Correct.
And 40s and then is elevated back up
Correct.
On a nice
but
trend line.
But I do think that, to Steve's point, Steve, there is something about Braden Smith that it's a moxie, right? I mean, you coached tennis, right?
I did.
So can you see, and when you, I'm curious of this, do you find yourself, when you watch sports today, can you see like kind of a look or a focus within an athlete of a personal discipline that you can tell translates to the point where in that particular moment they allow themselves to be bigger than the moment is.
Yeah, I think you can take someone with the same athletic skills, two different players, but one of them has that kind of ability to go within themselves and get fired up and take it to another level. Going back to the North Central Tennis days, there was a player named David McCallum.
Yep.
Hell of a player. You know, wasn't the tallest guy, didn't hit it the hardest, but he was the hardest competitor. I mean, you would not beat him in a 20-20 ball rally. You know, you just get that sense with Braden Smith. Fourth quarter, he's going to dig in. He's going to fire. And it not only fires him up, but fires his teammates up.
From a coaching standpoint, can you coach that drive within somebody, or does that literally come within one's personal chemistry?
Oh, I think that's just innate. I mean, Caitlin has it as well. You know, that's just kind of a inner ferociousness that you either have or you don't.
Right. And you know what? Jimmy, Braden Smith is one of those that I remember when he was a junior in high school, somebody saying to me, the best player in the state is this kid, Braden Smith. And I'm like, what? He's tiny, right?
Yeah, undersized. And
he looks bigger when he's playing. Correct. You think he's like 6'4", right?
Yes. The way he carries himself, the way he has developed over the last year alone. Like, he was a part of that core of Purdue guards himself, Fletcher Lawyer, that you looked at a year ago and you said, this is the Achilles heel. You go let them try to beat you, and you're not going to lose. Eventually, Purdue's going to bow out, and that's not the case because he's been one of the top guards in the country this entire season. Again, I'm not worried about at this stage, and maybe Purdue fans still are, and I would understand if they are. One of my closest friends is a diehard Purdue fan, and there's still the when's the other shoe going to drop type feeling. I get that, but I don't think if Purdue falls short of a Final Four or national championship, it's going to be because they hurt Purdue. I think the only way to beat them is you just happen to outscore them on a night. Like, it's not going to be where they marginally – it's going to be marginal. It's not going to be like a huge bad game. It might be instead of 9 turnovers, they commit 12. They make 10, you make 15 threes, something like that.
There's something else that I think Purdue has learned over the course of the year, in a year where there wasn't a lot of learning to be done, that can be a difference maker for them, in particular in these next two games, assuming that they get two of them and not just one. I'll tell you what that is, and we're going to go to Chicago, not literally, but figuratively, because Jeremiah Johnson's there. We're going to talk to him in 15, previewing Pacers Bulls.
Don't want the worry of maintaining your furnace or air conditioner?
or 1 o'clock anywhere in the Eastern time zone. My name is Jake Query, Jimmy Cook here as well, having some sort of subtle humor with Eddie Garrison. Are you guys
talked
passing
you
notes
talked
over there?
You talked over the liner.
Are your ears not working?
I can't hear it. My headset.
Okay.
Sorry. This jack here, I can hear us, but I can't hear music the music being
played. Okay. Yeah, we don't share secrets, Jake. It was just a look, and then a laugh. That's all it was.
Well, you can let me know these things, right? Steve Wagner, who I'm sure is impressed by this well-oiled machine, is hanging out with us today. Steve, as part of the fundraiser to raise money against colorectal cancer and the Blue Hope Bash, joining us. We were just talking about Purdue, and Steve, what I was saying where I think Purdue, one of the things that they have learned, you know, a year ago, if you go back, and I think now maybe we can exercise these demons because they got out of the first two rounds here, but to use it as a barometer, when they lost to Fairleigh Dickinson last year in the first round of the tournament, it was a game where Zach Edey was still basically being Zach Edey, but A, he wasn't getting much help, and B, it was like people didn't really know who was supposed to step up and be that auxiliary role. And it seems to me now like Purdue has very defined, in other words, it's great to get a 30-20 game from Zach Edey, but you tell me if you disagree. It doesn't feel like they necessarily need that night in and night out, because if for some reason, and it's been a long time since we've seen it, but if for some reason he is having a quote-unquote off night, then you have a very defined pecking order of guys that are going to step into the roles of whatever contribution is being vacated.
Yeah, they're definitely, I think, have more insurance against the catastrophic Zach Edey game or foul trouble. I mean, there's two or three guys that can go for 20. They need to. They can buckle down on defense and win a scrappy game. So I think that they're better suited for a run than they were last year.
And that, Jimmy, maybe part of that's the maturation of Braden Smith, but also I think we've talked about it maybe ad nauseum, but Fletcher Lawyer's emergence in his comfort level kind of being recaptured here at the right time. That's what we talked about all year. And so far, Lawyer looks to me loose, right, Jimmy? Like, that's the big key, is he looks like he's ready for the moment, kind of, and like he's welcoming it. And then a guy like Mason Gillis, who knows when he needs to go out there and get his buckets, and he still is capable of doing it, but he doesn't overstep his boundary, if that makes sense.
Yeah, and then on top of that, and I'm still waiting for this to happen at some point in the tournament, I think it's going to, how many times throughout the regular season was there maybe a brief lull or maybe a 6-0 run by the opposition, and then you get a couple triples or a couple nice plays from Lance Jones? Like, he so often was viewed as the key, I don't want to say fix, but the key addition from this past offseason that kind of helped level things out offensively for Purdue, combined with the growth of Braden Smith, of Fletcher Lawyer, of Mason Gillis. Lance Jones, I'm still waiting for that big signature tournament moment from him. They don't need to have it. Let's be honest. They are one of the
top.
Don't
you feel like that with Jones, if there's a big Jones breakout game, it's not necessarily a good thing? Does that make sense? In other words,
sure.
If you have a game where he leads you in scoring, that's like, ooh, wait a minute.
I guess what I'm looking for is more of a microcosm moment where he goes on a little bit of a 6-0 run where maybe there is a lull here and there. But I will say, you mentioned the Boilermakers being out of the woods in terms of being out of the first weekend and the second weekend. Another note on that, in terms of not being worried as a fan about, oh, losing to a lesser opponent, there's no lesser opponents left. There's no St. Peter's this year on their side of the bracket. Everybody they are going up against to get to the Final Four,
correct,
would be top tier of the top tier of college basketball, whether it's Creighton, whether it's Tennessee, and then this Friday, of course, against
Gonzaga.
Who are
the three, Jimmy, weakest teams left in the Sweet 16?
Based on just of work alone this year, I would say NC State. And I hate to say that because they've really caught fire. I'd say NC State,
Clemson,
Alabama.
What about San Diego State?
Man, I like the Aztecs, man. I think
I
that's going to be a great
them.
Game.
I don't know anything about them. They played in the national title game last year. They're a 5 seed. I know nothing about
them. I think that's going
to
be a great game.
San Diego.
Game.
You been to San Diego? Steve, you been to San Diego?
No.
Oh, my goodness.
I would have labeled Gonzaga as one of the weaker teams prior to what they did to Kansas. Like, I would have viewed them in that category.
Yeah,
I
think Gonzaga's put things together here of late.
For
right?
sure. I just mean, with who's left, they might have been in that list for me of, if you make me choose between the best of the field, who is the weak one, it might have been Gonzaga, and then they just destroyed Kansas in the second half.
You ever
of that
had
game.
That Garrett's popcorn in Chicago?
I love the Garrett's popcorn
in Chicago.
I think
it's very overrated.
All right, then. Thank you for that
you like
segue.
It? Steve,
I do.
You ever had it?
That a little
Garrett's
caramel
popcorn
and cheddar?
Chicago?
Come on.
I mean, it's good. No, don't get me wrong. It's good. I do like it. But, like, people in Chicago will throw you down a flight of stairs for it. I'm like, the Just Pop In's fine. It does just fine, right?
Yeah, it's what's great. Next? You're going to go after Portillo's? Yeah. What else do you have a problem with?
Yeah, it's also kind of overrated. All right. Right. But anyway, I don't know if Jeremiah Johnson's got any Garrett's, but he's in Chicago. He joins us next.
The Ride with JMV.
Colts Hall of Famer Edgerrin James.
Hey, I heard it that time. I waited. See, I waited my turn to talk.
I believed in you.
My name is Jake Query. That is Jimmy Cook, whose voice you just heard. Steve Wagner hanging out with us as well from Wagner Reese Law Firm in Indianapolis. Our guest today in studio and joining us now in Chicago. And I'm going to have him weigh in on the Garrett's popcorn controversy. I don't dislike it, Jimmy, I just find it a bit overrated. Jeremiah Johnson from Pacers Television, Pacers and Bulls from the Windy City. Jeremiah, have you had that Garrett's popcorn in Chicago?
I have, and I must say I'm not surprised that you have an issue with people liking it.
I don't have issue with people liking it. It's the fact that people from Chicago, you talk to anybody from Chicago, and they're like, oh, it's the best in the city. You can't get anything like it anywhere else. It's the greatest thing ever. And I'm like, Just Pop In is fine. It's just as good. The indie style from Just Pop In, just as good. I think it's fine. I think it's sufficient.
Where do you come down on In-N-Out Burger?
Love it. Absolutely love it. Had it three times last week in Vegas. I was there 5 days.
What about Jake? Overrated,
okay,
right?
No, here's the thing. In-N-Out Burger is like Yingling. Yingling beer, like for a while there, it's like you're going out east. Oh, my gosh, you got to get Yingling. You can't get it in Indiana. It's the greatest thing ever. And the smartest thing that In-N-Out Burger has ever done is not expanded beyond the Pacific time zone or the Mountain time zone, because it becomes like this coveted thing that you can't have. It's good.
It's a pilgrimage, Jake.
It's good. It's perfectly sufficient, but it is not as good as Fatburger. It's better than Whataburger, and it's not as good as Steak and Shake. Shake Shack, overrated. Your thoughts, Jeremiah. Go ahead.
I'll disagree with you, actually. I think In-N-Out Burger is atop my list. I do like Shake Shack. And I think if you put it on a few markets east of the Mississippi, you wouldn't affect your West Coast money.
I think when people go to L.A. or, you know, California, stopping at In-N-Out is so high on the list because you can't get it, right? So, and then you're like, oh, my gosh, give me Patties of Jamaica. I'll go to 52nd Allisonville, get Patties of Jamaica. It's better than any of it.
That's true. All right. you bring up some valid points, but I guess it's similar to the Garrett's, though. I didn't go get it this time, but there have been times I've been in Chicago, and I've made the pilgrimage over to get some to bring some home, and it's just one of those things you do, and I don't tend to have a problem with it, but again, it's probably not quite as good as everyone makes it out to be.
What about that Tim Hortons when you're in Toronto? People throw you down a flight of stairs over Tim Hortons, the Timbits. They're just stale donut holes. Do you get into the Timbits, too?
No, but I think their coffee's outstanding, and I don't like every coffee. Like, I'm not even really a big Starbucks fan, but I really enjoy the Tim Hortons coffee, and their donuts are good, and we happen to have one right near our hotel, so I have nothing bad to say about Tim Hortons.
You're like Kramer with the free Java world. Fine. All right, so let's talk about the game tonight. Listen, reality is this. The Pacers have had some good moments here, Jeremiah, and I'm going to begin with the first question, which is, now that we've had kind of a sample size of how they look without Benedict Mathurin, that has led to increased minutes for who, and it has led to areas where he is most seen, his absence is most noticed, how?
Well, the one thing is that in the second unit, T.J. McConnell's role has increased. Even though he was playing quite a bit alongside Benedict Mathurin, you needed a little bit of scoring punch in the second unit. So I'm not sure if his minutes per game have increased without Benedict Mathurin, but he's probably having the best month of his entire career. And I don't think it's a stretch what Chris and Quinn brought up during the broadcast to say that he won't win Sixth Man of the Year, nor maybe should he, but he at least should be mentioned by some. And if you have a ballot where you list 3 to 5 players, I'd be hard-pressed to find 3 to 5 players who've been a consistent bench player the entire season that haven't really been injured, that has been impactful as T.J. McConnell. So it may not be the answer that you expected with that question. You know, Ben Shepherd, someone who's gotten more of an opportunity with Benedict Mathurin out, and that was, you know, by necessity. You needed to have someone else play some second-unit minutes. But I think what T.J. McConnell's done since Mathurin was injured is noteworthy, and every single time they need something from him, he's able to provide it. Late in games, you would like to have that explosiveness from Benedict Mathurin, but the other thing is, now that you've got Pascal Siakam doing what he's doing, and he's also anchoring some second unit minutes, the group that played to start the fourth quarter was fascinating to me, that you had T.J. McConnell, Ben Shepherd, Jairus Walker, Jalen Smith, and Pascal Siakam, a group that I had not seen play together, and they look like they've been playing together the entire season. So credit the coaching staff for being able to make up for the absence of Benedict Mathurin and some of those players for taking advantage of different roles and opportunities.
Jeremiah Johnson of Valley Sports is our guest. Jeremiah, over this road trip, the Pacers so far are 3-1. That lone loss to the Lakers in a shootout that reminded me very much of very early season Pacers, that 151-45 loss, and then they finally get a win in the second night of a back-to-back over L.A., now conclude against Chicago. Let's say they're able to get a win tonight, 4-1 on the road trip. Where would you assess the road trip from the standpoint of where they grew the most? Is it Tyrese Haliburton looking like he's finally getting out of that shooting slump? Is it, as Jake's highlighted a couple times on the show, the reemergence or first-time emergence of Jairus Walker? If you could point to a couple spots of where you're most proud of their growth over this road trip, where would it be?
Yeah, the Jairus Walker one is something that could really help this team the rest of the regular season into the playoffs. We'll see what happens tonight, because there have been these moments where the team's needed Jairus Walker and he's delivered, but for some reason, what we saw against the Clippers feels a little bit different. It wasn't just playing spot minutes and, you know, maybe having a good stretch on offense or defense. The fact that he was the one who started the second half was a sign of the confidence that the coaching staff has in him, and then he was able to deliver the floor game that he had. The key for him is probably to play the three, is to be able to hit shots consistently, because if he knocks down a couple of shots early and he's not playing the four but he's playing the three, that opens up the playmaking. And so that could be, see what happens tonight, but if he plays tonight, plays well, then I do think it could be the Jairus Walker road trip. But a lot of things have happened. I mean, you've seen in two games Pascal Siakam combined for 67 points. On this road trip, you also saw Miles Turner break the franchise record for blocks. And you saw Tyrese Haliburton in two of the last three games hit three-point shots of such a high degree of difficulty that I think we can maybe stop talking about the slump. He brought it up again after the game on Monday that he hadn't been shooting as well. But I think even he needs to say, you know, that's in the past. You don't see a guy do what he did against the Warriors and the Clippers. And he didn't really shoot poorly against the Lakers. He didn't just shoot as much. And so there are a lot of different things you could point to on this road trip. Almost all of them are positive. And to have a stretch where four to five different guys are having real positive statements this late in the season, and you have an opportunity to win four or five on the road, the timing's perfect.
Jeremiah, are there any areas of Tyrese Haliburton's game? Jeremiah Johnson of Pacers Television, Valley Sports is our guest. Throughout the time where Haliburton has had to, I guess, find ways other than the step back three to really, you know, that was his bread and butter there for a streak when he was really hot. But during that slump, have there been any areas of his game that you have seen that actually may benefit in the long run, because it forced him to kind of go back to his basics, and that will only cement his versatility later into, like, say, a playoff run?
Well, you want him to be able to go attack the basket and finish through contact, and I saw that in Detroit. And that's where this road trip got off to the good start, even though it was just the Pistons. His numbers were good, but it was the way he did it by attacking the basket and seeing those shots go down. And, you know, the other thing is he was getting a lot of those open looks early in the season, in part because of the way they moved offensively, the way he and Buddy Hield would execute those ghost screens. And it's just not the same right now. They don't run offense the same. And the thing that he's been able to do so effectively on this road trip that I think can help moving forward is not feel the pressure every time you need a big shot to be the guy that has to make the shot, to have the confidence that you can either run some offense or just get the ball to Pascal Siakam and get out of his way. They didn't have a player like that. I mean, you had Buddy Hield, you had Bruce Brown. Those are players that helped you, and you, like I said, you ran offense just a little bit differently. But now that they are more healthy and comfortable with what Pascal Siakam does, the biggest thing to me is that Haliburton maybe feels less pressure. And instead of it's you've got this star player and everyone else is below him, I feel like you've got two stars right now. And to go into a fourth quarter or a clutch time situation or just even a difficult stretch of the game and you've got two of those guys on the court, it makes it that much more difficult to defend, and then that makes him that much more difficult to double. If you double Tyrese Haliburton, you know he's going to find the open guy. If one of those guys might be Pascal Siakam, you can pretty much mark down 2 points for the Pacers.
Jeremiah, I went to that Bulls game a few weeks ago and saw them just completely unable to stop DeMar DeRozan down the stretch. What is it about the Bulls that the Pacers struggle with? And, you know, are they going to do anything different tonight from what you've heard to try to get a win that they really should get?
Yeah, it's a good question because the Bulls are a hard-playing team. They're not the best team. And DeMar DeRozan is someone you think as long as he's been playing in the league, he can't do what he does. And he doesn't shoot three-pointers. He's more of a mid-range guy. But I would say he's as good now as I've ever seen him, and that's, you know, a credit to him and where he's at right now. Some of this is just the timing of when you play someone, and so it's not great for the Pacers that the Bulls have lost three in a row and they just were sort of embarrassed at home by the Washington Wizards. So timing-wise, it doesn't play well to the Pacers. You had that road trip. You're adjusting to time zones. You're playing a Bulls team that, while they're not good, they're still going to be in the play-in tournament, and they want to figure some things out. So schematically, you don't know necessarily what their plans are, but my guess would be you devote even more attention to DeMar DeRozan. You start doubling him maybe just a little bit quicker. And a key player for them is Alex Caruso. He's really good defensively. He was listed as questionable. So I'll be watching that injury report. If Caruso's not available, it really does help the Pacers. If he is available and healthy, he'll make it harder on the Pacers' backcourt to get things going. He just really mucks things up, and he can knock down some shots as well. So the other thing about the Bulls, they're usually a team that's good at rebounding, and that's one of the things the Pacers need to always be cognizant of, especially in close games, is to secure the defensive rebounds. Vucevic is a guy that has caused them problems. So but just the fact that you lost that game that you mentioned, that does leave a bitter taste in everyone's mouth, the only overtime game the Pacers have played, that should be all the motivation you need. In fact, the next two games, you've got a Bulls team that you should not be happy about losing to, and you always want revenge against LeBron. That's the game coming up on Friday. I like having those two opportunities, even though the travel and the road trip, it does create a little bit of a more challenging scenario for the Pacers right now.
Jeremiah Johnson of Bally Sports is our guest. Jeremiah, I've been of the camp since the offseason that this team was good enough to hold a sixth seed or better in the Eastern Conference playoff picture, and things obviously change with their expectations when they go get Pascal Siakam, but a game and a half lead with nine to play, including one matchup still against your closest opponent for that sixth seed in the Miami Heat. How do you assess things? How do you assess the lock-in of this group with just nine games left and only a game and a half worth of cushion to work with?
This is really, you know, all you could ask for. I mean, to be in this position when the season started, there was no talk of wanting to be a play-in tournament team. There was talk of being a playoff team. You can get there through the play-in tournament, but you lock it in by being a sixth seed. The biggest thing that this team has to be able to do, they've done a really good job responding to adversity. You have a bad loss, you bounce back. They've stepped up against challenging opponents. Can you deal with success? I feel like tonight's game is one of those situations where if you start the road trip and you say, you know, we'll give you a 3-2 record, will you take it? People probably would. Now that you're 3-1, you can't relax and you can't be satisfied. And that's where I think tonight's game is really even more important than many of the others, because it'll show if this team can deal with the success but also is not satisfied. You'd like to get to that last week of the season where you don't need that Miami win. It'll be it should be an intense atmosphere, and I think Miami, no matter what, will need it. But maybe the Pacers can create a little separation, and can they get to that point where you go into that last week knowing that you'll have that week off? That's where this team should be. And at 41 wins right now with nine to play, I've said this with Pat Boylan a couple of times on the podcast recently. I said it a couple weeks ago. If you get to 47, I think that's going to get you in the top six. 46 is a question mark. So 5-4, the final nine will get you to 46, but you might be seven right there. And so I've maintained all along, if you get to 47, I think that's where you're going to be. Tonight's game gets you to 42. Then you've got just eight left. They're in the position they wanted to be. Now, if they can just stay healthy and keep some of this defensive improvement that we've seen, the offensive confidence with Siakam, they should be able to get there.
When you go on these multi-game road trips, Jeremiah, do you recycle sport coats and then just put new ties so that nobody can notice the difference? Or do you have to bring like five different coats if you're on a five-game trip?
Good question. Usually it's three or four, so there'll be a suit that's worn twice, sport coat usually once. Usually just one shirt, but I have to admit I had a little bit of a travel drama issue in Detroit. For some reason, I didn't put the shirts in the suitcase when I left. So I only had, for the Laker game, the shirt that I wore, or I should say the Warriors game, the shirt that I wore to Detroit. So I had to do a little shopping once I got to Los Angeles. So best laid plans normally are for a five-game trip, 3 to 4 sport coats, but definitely wearing one twice, and you're correct, usually 5 different types.
I would think for the pocketbook purposes that the worst place in the NBA to have to suddenly go out and buy shirts would be L.A., right?
Well, I found a Nordstrom Rack pretty close to the hotel, so
nice.
I was in good shape there.
You know, I once, Jeremiah, I once, and you actually might have been with me when we were working at rivaling TV stations, and I won't say what the story was because it was not a positive one, but I had to fly out of state on short notice and needed a suit to go cover something for Channel 6, and they lost my lug. I had, like, the little garment bag or whatever, and I checked it, and they lost it. And so I had to go to Walmart at 9 o'clock in the morning and buy a suit, and the only thing they had was a 42, like, at double XL. So I was literally doing stand-ups wearing John Candy's suit with Huck Finn pants. It was, and the best part about it is the suit was $79, and like, everybody was like, that suit was beautiful. Like, that's the most amazing suit. So I went and got it tailored. I still have it, and I tell people that I bought it at, like, in Los Angeles at some store, and they're like, well, that is wonderful. So see, the Nordstrom Rack shirts will pay off.
You know,
for you.
If you have to go buy something like that, you're going to get other use out of it. So
of course, I just
freaked out at about 3:30 on Friday when I'm getting dressed, and I said, "Where are my shirts?" And at least I had one at that point, because it was going to have to be a quick walk somewhere in San Francisco, which would have probably been even worse than what you mentioned about Los Angeles on short notice.
Well, here's my other question. So it's 12:20 in Chicago right now, right? One of the great cities, and trust me, just ask anybody from Chicago, they'll tell you. One of the great cities in the United States.
I mean, they got Garrett's popcorn, right?
Yeah, you can go get your Garrett's, you can get all your and yet you're holed up in the Howard Johnson's talking to us. I mean, what's going on there?
In his defense, it's pretty cold right now, I'd say, right, compared to what we've experienced, well, for him for this road trip, but us especially.
I don't know, what's the temperature out in Chicago right now?
It's not bad, actually. I mean, the sun's shining. I would say it's high 50s.
Jeremiah, I tried to go to bat for you. What are you doing there? Just lie and say it's 20 and windy.
We all have phones, Jimmy. We can tell. So what's on the docket? I want to know what's on the schedule for the rest of the day. Do you get to go out and explore? Like, you're going to, you know, go walk past the water tower? What are you doing?
Team pick at the bean with Denari? Let's go.
Yeah.
Come on.
Well, I have a 5K to still do at the treadmill in the hotel, because I have a challenge to do a 5K at every single hotel that we go to, and I didn't get a chance to do it last night in Chicago. So that's the top of my list. I've still got some prep to do for the pregame show. I'm guessing that bus will head to the United Center a little quicker than I need it to be. So, unfortunately, I don't have any great stories for you. I'm not visiting any movie stars' homes. I'm not visiting any cemeteries like you like to do on your road trips. This will be
lots
kind
of movies
a boring Chicago trip. But one of the highlights is just going to be talking to you guys.
What a guy.
That's a glaring show of your life. Here's the thing. Why don't you just run to the United Center? It's 5K away, right? What the hell?
Yeah, then I'd probably need to buy another shirt.
I mean, you know, you want me to do all the planning for you here? For crying out loud. All right, Jeremiah, tonight it is Pacers and Bulls. That game getting underway. Eddie, give me the start time one more time.
8 o'clock.
8 o'clock tip, and you will see Jeremiah along with Eddie Gill, Chris Denari, Quinn Buckner, the rest of them, and then afterwards you can tune it in to Eddie Squared and listen to the world's greatest postgame show when you're not listening to Mark here on the station as well. Jeremiah, we appreciate it.
All right, I'll bring you back some popcorn, and I'll give it to the rest of the crew, but not to you, Jake.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Indy style, you just go over there in Broderpool, get your just pop in. It's the same thing. It's the same thing as the Garrett's. I'm not saying it's not good, Jimmy.
See, here's the problem. You wouldn't care about this because, as we've grown to know each other through the course of this show, I know you wouldn't care, but the response for somebody that would care would be like, Jake, that'd be like somebody going to St. Elmo's and be like, you know that cocktail sauce, overrated. Not a big fan. But I know you probably wouldn't. You'd be like, okay, cool, man. You wouldn't care. But that's the same level of thing when you go and attack In-N-Out or Garrett's.
I'm not attacking it. Okay, Steve, have my back. Steve Wagner is here. You went to Notre Dame, so I'm assuming you probably had friends from Chicago, right?
Oh, yeah. Yep.
Spent some time in the Windy City, right?
Sure.
Okay. Have you ever had the Garrett's popcorn?
I have.
Thoughts?
just like any other popcorn.
Yes. See?
I mean, it's either hot, it's fresh, it's, you know, or it's not.
Right. You know what's good? Have you had, I think it's called Market Square Popcorn Company. It's available in Castleton Square, and they have one that's called like a, it's like a heat. It's kind of, it's sweet heat is what it's called.
Okay. I've not had that.
I might have to bring some in for you guys tomorrow.
By the way, I went on record just to distance myself from this whole thing, and Jake didn't say this either. St. Elmo's cocktail sauce and the shrimp cocktail as a whole, not overrated, delicious dish, one of my favorites. Shout out to St. Elmo's and Harry Nizzi's. A whole lot.
Listen, here's the thing, though, about, and I love everything about St. Elmo and the shrimp cocktail sauce, right? I do like that anytime that any, it, like, if you were a sports fan living in, you know, I don't know, Oklahoma City, every time a Colts game is on, aren't you saying to yourself, like, are they going to show me that shrimp cocktail sauce again?
Probably.
Because literally, like every NCAA tournament, like the little bumper shots, they constantly are showing it. You know what I mean? But it's become a staple of the city for sure, more so than, like, Garrett's in Chicago. If you're watching a Bears game, it's not like they're showing you the Garrett's, but you go through the airport, and the line, this is what I understand at O'Hare. You're going to O'Hare, you're running, you got 20 minutes to get from one spot to the next, which actually is like going from Evanston to Skokie. And you pass this, there's this line 100 deep of people, and you're like, what is this all about? And they're waiting in line for popcorn. And then you realize they're all Chicagoans, because nobody that's flying through there from Macon, Georgia is that concerned about stopping to get it. Why? Because when they land in Indy, they can just get the Indy style from Just Pop In, and it's the same thing.
I will say, since you brought up Georgia, the one spot at any airport, and I did it on my journey to Vegas last week, that is always crowded. It's always crowded anywhere you go, airport, mall, whatever, Chick-fil-A. Chick-fil-A stands the test of time. Those lines will always be stacked. And I will fight you on this if you're going to tell me that's overrated.
But Jimmy, no, here's the thing.
Okay.
Steve will vouch for me on this.
All right.
Okay. Steve, you grew up on the north side, correct?
Correct.
There have been Chick-fil-A's in Castleton Square Mall. There was a double-decker Chick-fil-A. You remember that?
I do.
It was good, right? They always had the guys handing out the little samples, and you'd get it, and you're like,
go,
oh, it's good.
Three or four times and load up.
Yeah. That's exactly right. But there was – what happened where all of a sudden – and it was like – 10 years ago, maybe 8 years ago, Chick-fil-A went from being a good, it's never been bad, don't get me wrong, but why all of a sudden now are the lines constantly, any hour of the day, wrapped all the way around and causing traffic jams on Keystone when it's been there for 30 years? It's not like it's new. What is it?
Can't
is it the
that
deterioration
one.
Of customer service everywhere else?
I don't know. The one in Westfield is top-notch. They're always getting you in and out of there as quick as possible.
They get you in and out of any of them. That's
I think the pricing of Chick-fil-A has come closer to what all the other fast food chains are, and now you get a better bang for your buck between Chick-fil-A, McDonald's, Wendy's, Burger King, et cetera, et cetera.
That's actually a pretty good answer, right? That's not a bad answer. So when I complimented you, Eddie, you know what you're supposed to say then?
The Pacers have no more Sega Babas?
You're supposed to say, my pleasure. Robbie Hummel is next.
Can you handle the truth about your problem gambling?
Okay. What classic movie of the 1970s does this song make a cameo? Late 70s.
Can't help you.
Steve Wagner, who's joining us in studio, he is the official legal representation for the show. He's protecting all of us and for our word missteps in the future from Wagner Reese Law Firm here as part of the Blue Hope Bash. Steve, I'll give you a hint. Jamie Lee Curtis was in this movie. 1978 it came out. It takes place in Haddonfield, Illinois, despite being palm trees and mountains in the background.
Is it a gore movie?
It was. She's being stalked by a guy in a bleached William Shatner mask.
Jason?
Close. Michael Myers. Halloween.
Oh, Michael Myers. Oh. Yeah.
See,
I only watched small parts of her movies.
I have seen that, but I wouldn't have forgot that was in there.
It's a very brief period. By the way, Blue Oyster Cult, Don't Fear the Reaper, is the ringtone for none other than Mike Chappell's phone, or was at one time. Robbie Hummel, by the way, last second assignment, apparently may be joining us later in the program. Brad Miller at 2 o'clock. Steve, we were just talking about Chick-fil-A. So I'm not crazy here because Todd came in and said, I don't think it was in Castleton. It was definitively in the mall, like in the mid 80s, right?
It was. Yeah. As we talked, just near Farrell's.
Which was the best?
Gobstoppers the size of your fist.
What about Hot Sam pretzels? Do you ever load up on a Hot Sam pretzel?
Oh, yeah.
Max and Irma's, pick up the phone, call people at the other table.
Call the old people and, you know.
the Sunday bar was awesome. You could make a sweet Sunday at Max and Irma's. Last night, Indiana State. Jimmy, I want to revisit back into that. I thought, as I was watching that game against Cincinnati, two things came to mind. Number one, I'm happy for Indiana State, as I talked about at the outset of the show, because, and this sounds like I'm being, like, patronizing. I don't want it to seem that way at all. But I feel like people that went to Indiana State, you know, if you go to IU, you have IU basketball over the years to, like, get excited about and bond over. If you go to Purdue, you've got right now what Purdue's doing, and then they've had good football teams as well and special moments. Ball State, you know, Letterman has made the Ball State things just cool in general. And Indiana State, I think, other than Larry Bird, people that went to Indiana State, a lot of them have just been like, there's almost like this hesitation of like, well, I went to Indiana State, but I am an IU fan, but I am a Purdue fan, you know, whatever it might be. And I truly mean this. Like, if you're an Indiana State fan, like, push the chest out, man. Like, your time is now. It's awesome. They are as much a toast of college basketball by not being in the tournament as any team that we've seen that has been snubbed in the last 15 years. I mean, there have been teams in the past that have gone through an NIT run, you know, Minnesota or something, and it's like, oh, yeah, okay, the NIT's going on. But Indiana State is, like, representing. They are literally this representation of – they're kind of like the Hickory Huskers. Like, we want to win this for all the little schools that couldn't get here. Dick Vitale and national writers are all on board with Indiana State because they represent the team, Jimmy, and the program and the resume that did everything that was asked and still got snubbed.
Yeah, they didn't go away quietly like some of those other teams did, right? They so often, and even this year especially, you see teams opting out left and right. That was never something Indiana State was going to do. Indiana State wanted an opportunity to play postseason basketball, to have this group together one more time, and not just for a feel-good story, to go out and try to win the whole thing. And to your point about why they might, an Indiana State fan might be like, oh, but I root for this team, I root for that team. They've been to 3 tournaments this century, 01, 2000, and then 2011. Like, this was supposed to be another chapter for Indiana State basketball, and the crowning achievement was a second weekend, maybe, to a Sweet 16. And instead, they took the snub. We griped about it. A lot of people griped about it. And instead of feeling sorry for themselves, where they could have easily laid down in that first game against SMU, or they could have easily called it quits against Minnesota, or even last night against Cincinnati, they're on a mission to go win what would be an NIT championship, sure, but a national title in its own right. That would be a fitting end to a story that, you know, look, yes, the NCAA tournament's better. Everybody knows that. I'm sure if you gave truth serum to the Sycamores, they wish they were a part of the Sweet 16 conversation versus the NIT Final Four. But they're there, and they're going to have a good chance to win the whole thing.
Absolutely. I mean, first off, the environment's going to be awesome Tuesday night.
Great.
Right?
A historic venue like Hinkle combined with this story, I hope Sycamores pack the house because it's going to be crazy.
I thought last night, two things jumped out at me. Number one, Jizzle James, and it does feel odd to say the name, Edgerrin James' son is really good because you don't see what he has is he's a strong and like bouncy guard. Like he can kind of bounce between areas. It's kind of hard to explain unless you're watching it. But he is very physically gifted. But A, he did not appear – they were talking about his stamina. Now, he did miss a few shots late in the game that maybe he would have liked to have had back. But his mid-range game is really strong, and you don't see a lot of guards that can pull up all of a sudden like, you know, the T.J. McConnell style, kind of circle around, pull up 10, 12 feet and hit a mid-range jumper. He was able to do that very effectively, and it allowed Cincinnati to build a lead where, to be honest with you, it looked like Indiana State was going to be in serious trouble. But then the threes start falling for Indiana State. They were 13-30 from beyond the arc, but at key moments, they hit big shots. Avila hit big shots, but also his ability to facilitate and distribute from the high post into either cutting guards or back out into the outside to open shooters. They spaced the floor so well, Jimmy, as well as anybody in college basketball. And when you look at the fact that Indiana State has, you know, three, four guys on the floor at any time that can consistently shoot from outside, and then you look at a Cincinnati that have guards that can get into the lane and shoot from the mid-range, it does leave you frustrated why other programs can't seemingly get any guard play at all.
They've also taken care of the basketball far better than they have at any stretch this season. So far, three consecutive games, the first time all year, where they've had 10 or fewer turnovers. That's happened during this run in the NIT. So you combine that, taking care of the basketball, with the way they play offense, they're a fun watch, but they're also a tough out, regardless of who the matchup is. And that's why we wanted them to be in the field. Because you can't tell me, even if they were a play-in game, you can't tell me that they would have laid the type of egg that Virginia did against Colorado State. You can't tell me that they wouldn't have had a little bit more success in a first-round matchup in the NCAA tournament, but they did not cry over spilled milk, Jake. They decided to go ahead and push forward. And now it's the type of thing where even if an NCAA banner is in a separate class, which it is, the idea of getting to have a national championship banner, a national invitational tournament banner in Terre Haute is very much a real possibility.
By the way, those tickets I bought, Steve, we were talking about this. I bought tickets last night with like 2 minutes to go in the game for Tuesday night's game. They've now tripled. Now, do I still hold on to them?
Where are you at right now?
What's my obligation to JMV here? Like, what's my friend obligation here? So without saying the prices, the total that I paid after fees, okay? The total that I paid for two tickets after fees right now is $45 less than a single ticket in the same section is going for right now.
So we talking 3x you're at right now?
I'm talking three times the amount. Yeah.
I think if you get to 5x, JMV's out.
Yeah. I kind of agree with that. Yeah.
Since you're an attorney, can you draft up the letter to let him know this?
I will take care of that. Yeah.
Will you charge me fees for that?
One-third of your profits.
There it is. Yeah. There's always a cut. Jake.
So I only work on a contingent basis.
I was gonna say, but I'm telling you, like. But it's going to be, Jimmy, the tickets sold out for Tuesday last night before midnight. And the game ended at what time? Like 11:15?
If that, yeah.
I mean, the other teams, Georgia, Virginia Commonwealth, Utah, and Seton Hall, it's going to be two of the, three of those other teams are going to be here, right?
Yeah.
And, like, I don't know. I mean, well, Georgia's already here, I guess, right?
Yes.
And then... But those fans, they've got no shot, right, at getting a ticket. And that's why people are talking about how I saw somebody that said John Rothstein had sent a tweet last night or a post, whatever you want to call it, that said this Indiana State team is super fun and they should be in the tournament. And it's unfortunate that they are being denied the possibility to play in basketball's Mecca. And I love the Garden. Steve, you been to the Garden?
Oh, yeah.
It's fabulous, right?
It is. It is a little bit of history.
I mean, that's exactly it. Like, when you go, you could go on a Tuesday afternoon to go see the circus at the Garden, and it feels like a big event just because the train and, you know, everything that goes into Madison Square Garden, it's magical. But Jimmy, the reality is this: if Indiana State and Georgia are playing at Madison Square Garden in the NIT semifinal, what are you getting? 8,000 people, maybe 3,000 or 4,000 that live in the area, yeah, and are going just to see it.
Correct.
But at Hinkle, and this is a total coup for the NIT to have an Indiana team playing at
massive.
Hinkle, right?
It's massive because you're gonna get Hinkle would be rocking regardless, but the idea of it being, and that's probably why your value on your tickets continue to rise, Jake, is because there is a large contingent of Indiana State alumni, whether it's students, whether it's former, whatever, graduates, etc., that are going to want to be a part of this moment because it's a historic moment for the program. And the idea of it being in the backdrop of a home state with a home school, I think it's going to validate a lot of the NIT's decision. I don't want to misquote it here, but I think the Garden had something to do with that as well. I don't know if they willingly moved or if it was a mutual split or why they've started to move it to different host sites, but to have it at another historic venue like Hinkle with a home state school, yeah, I'm expecting a sea of sky blue action from Indiana State.
Hey, Jake, the Garden is the world's most overrated venue. Here's the thing. Steve, when were you, what did you see? Have you been to an event in the Garden or just like been past it?
Yeah, I've been to a Pacer Knicks game.
Ooh, how was that?
We lost, so it wasn't great. But the experience was great.
Was it like Reggie Nicks era or just like a modern?
It was just after that. Okay. So, yeah, didn't quite have the same, there's no Spike Lee in the front row when I was there.
How did the fans treat you?
They were complete jerks. But I also lived in Philadelphia for a time and went to a Colts game in Philly, and that was the worst.
Oh, okay, so school me on that. How was it?
Oh, my God. I took the train in, went there. You know, I'm just out of law school. Excited to see the Colts. Eric Dicker. Who was? They had just drafted a great running back. Marshall Falk. It was Marshall Falk.
Okay, Falk. Yeah.
And I went in there and made the mistake of wearing a Colts jersey, and it was anything but brotherly.
I've seen videos like on social media of just casuals filming fans of the other team come through there. It's birds left and right. It's bleep you.
Well, they kind of take pride in it, right?
Oh, yeah, that's their identity. That
Did
is
you
the
like
identity
living in
of
Philly?
Philadelphia fan.
No. It unless you went to high school there or knew some guy, it was terrible. I mean, the one example I'll give you is I love to play pickup basketball, right? So I go out, walk down the street to the public park to play some basketball. I was just going to shoot around, right? I brought my own ball. And there's a bunch of guys gathering at the other end of the court on a Saturday morning, And then one of them wanders over to me and says, "So, are you looking to play in the game?" I'm like, "Well, yeah, sure." He's like, "Well, you got to talk to Joe." So I had to be interviewed by some 50-year-old guy, Joe. Yeah, what's your basketball pedigree?
You give him references?
I'm like, "My pedigree." I'm like, "I'm from Indiana." He's like, "All right, that's good enough, but pass first." I'm like, "Oh, God."
Hey, Steve, not a lot of people know this, but Jake actually finds cheesesteaks overrated. He's a big anti-cheesesteak guy.
Nah, they're okay, but you don't have to go to one of the big ones. Like, if you go to Philly and you ask for a cheesesteak, you got to go to I went to a place that's under an overpass, and it was awesome. And it was not the place that, Geno's or one of those.
Don't
right?
go to the one that's five stars on Travel Advisor.
You got to go to one of them. You got to go where the natives go, right? You got to go where Joe tells you to go, right?
Yeah, you got to go where Joe says. They got to have the certain type of bun, and it's got to be the exact type of cheese whiz. And
go to Hoagies and Hops, man, right here in India. That's my point. Now, the Garden, I will say this, in defense of those that think the Garden is overrated. You say that the Garden's not overrated because, Joe Lewis fought there, and this happened, and that happened. And then you're like, well, this is actually, the Garden 8, right? The one Joe Lewis fought in was three blocks over and seven buildings ago. Still called the Garden, but still, it is where Reggie slayed the Knicks.
Major League Baseball opening day.
song, by the way. We were just talking about music. Steve Wagner hanging out in studio with us for the day, all part of Blue Hope Bash, raising money to fight against colorectal cancer. And we were just talking music. Steve, like myself, you went and saw U2 in the Sphere. Pretty awesome, right?
Amazing experience.
Going back to see Dead & Company, you are?
I am.
That song that we just played was rated by Rolling Stone magazine as the worst song of the 80s.
Well deserved.
Jimmy, your thoughts?
I'll back Steve.
I mean, Men at Work would be a close second.
Steve, it's been good knowing you, man. Men at Work is awesome. Are you kidding me?
I had a friend in college who loved Men at Work. He had the posters up there. He played it nonstop. I think I had a little too much of a perhaps a good thing, and I soured on them.
Colin Hay is fabulous. He's the lead singer of Men at Work. Cargo is a very underrated album. And here's the thing. Most people, when they think of Men at Work, they go with Down Under. But It's a Mistake is a fabulous song. It's a Mistake is a fabulous song. And I saw Colin Hay. It was right on the as COVID was coming to an end, basically, and things were starting to reopen. Colin Hay, the lead singer of Men at Work, was at the Vogue. And I'm like, I have to meet Colin Hay. So I went there, and I was like kind of a groupie, and I hung around. And then I got a chance to go up and meet Colin Hay and get my photo taken with him. And he was very odd. I will say that. He was an odd bird, man. But I got my photo taken with him, so that was cool.
He had an accent?
He did have an accent. You know what's interesting is, being Australian, he's actually born and raised in Scotland. Well, not raised. He was born in Scotland, and then as a kid, his dad got transferred to Melbourne, Australia. So his accent is kind of more like Scottish. And he said, all he said actually was, Steve Wagner's Clueless. But he said, but I can't do the accent.
It sounded good, though, the way.
The way he said it sounded dead.
As long as you're not using your Irish accent.
That's right. Well, I have a fabulous, I don't know if you know.
Oh, your English. Is it your English accent?
That's right. Yes, yes, yes. It's a very popular accent.
I'm sorry, Jimmy.
He does have an Irish accent, too. So.
Yes, that's actually, it's more of a leprechaun.
It's a leprechaun walking on coals.
Pardon me, man.
It's a leprechaun walking on coals.
You like the U2, and I gotta go see the dead in the company atmosphere.
The Sphere is unbelievable, though, is it not? I mean, just the
it
overall.
It is a full visual auditory experience.
I thought the most impressive thing about it, as you and I were just talking about, but for those that are going to go see the Sphere, and the rumored next residency is, I believe, the Eagles. But there are going to be short-term shows of Dead & Company and of Phish. The thing to me that is amazing is the clarity of the sound. I mean, it literally sounded like you were getting a private show. I mean, it was that.
It comes at you from just everywhere.
Right. Which the only problem with that, if you were seeing Phish, is that that means you more clearly have to hear Phish, right?
I thought you might have been in an aquarium then. Sorry.
That's right. I'm telling you, are you a fish fan, Steve?
I haven't gotten full on board with fish yet. No.
Thank you.
I'm more a dead guy from back in the day.
Well, now Dead & Company, though, so John Mayer is doing it, right?
Yes.
Dumb question, I guess. How close is it to the original? I mean, obviously not Jerry Garcia, but like, is it more of like almost like a tribute to the Dead, or is it basically just him picking up as the Grateful Dead? They just didn't want to call it that because Jerry Garcia is not with them.
No, I think it's a reasonable continuation of the original band. I mean, there's enough of the similar sounds, and they always change things up from show to show anyway. So no, I think it's much more than a tribute.
Now, do you like Dave Matthews?
Oh yeah.
Okay.
Steve, if a band has been around since 1983, is there ever a point where it stops being, I haven't gotten on board with them yet, and, you know, I just don't like them?
You know, I think when you get to the 50-year point,
okay,
I think
sorry,
it really
sorry.
Starts to, like a fine wine.
If it hasn't happened by now,
yeah.
It's not going
no,
to.
No, yeah. I don't think so.
Jimmy, are you a fish head?
I'm not a fish head, no.
Who's your band?
I have a multitude of artists I listen to.
If you were going to pay Steve-type money to go out to the Sphere to see a band, it would be who?
Does that have to be a band or can it be a musical act?
Musical act.
I'd pay top dollar to go see Jay-Z.
Okay.
Mm.
Fair enough. Brad Miller, by the way, former Pacer, former Boiler, Purdue in the Sweet 16. He's going to join us to talk about that next.
The offseason is cold.
Purdue is in the Sweet 16. I don't know if you've heard that or not. They face the Bulldogs of Gonzaga. Jimmy, do you call them the Bulldogs or the Zags?
The Zags more often than not.
Steve Wagner, do you call them the Bulldogs or the Zags?
I'd say Zags.
But you like the fact that Braden Smith's got a little Bulldog in him, don't you?
He does. He does. He's gonna get right up in your business.
He does. Like I said, I know it sounds crazy, but he feels like he looks like he plays bigger than whatever he is, 6 foot. Like he looks 6'4", 6'5", out there, just the way his maneuverability and I don't know. He's a really good player, obviously. And
he's one of those players that the way he plays and the effortless that it feels like he's able to make passes or find driving lanes, the average Joe looks at that and says, oh, man, that's so easy what he's doing. But it's because of how talented and how much growth there's been over the last year that it looks that easy, Jake.
Yeah, I mean, he's obviously just a floor general in every sense of the word. But he carries on a long tradition of guys that went to Purdue that, you know, other schools look at and go, why did we not get him? You know, that kind of thing. And there have been a lot of those. I mean, obviously Steve Scheffler comes to mind. Jim Rowinski, who was a walk-on and became a first-team All-Big Ten performer, comes to mind. There are plenty of them. Brad Miller is one of those for certain, who, of course, became an NBA All-Star, two-time NBA All-Star, played for the Pacers out of Kendallville and East Noble High School. And then when he was with Purdue, I mean, Steve, you remember, he was just one of those guys that with each and every year progressed a little bit more, and before you know it, you're like, this guy is really good, right?
Yeah, when he came in, there's no way you would think that guy's going to the NBA, he's going to be an All-Star. You just didn't see it early in his career.
So we expect Brad Miller, by the way, to be joining us in just a couple of minutes here. We'll see if we can catch up to him living out in California now.
I bet he likes In-N-Out.
Think so?
Yeah.
You should ask him.
All right, I will.
We'll see. See if Eddie can track him down. I don't know if they have In-N-Out in Northern California, though. Steve, you spent much time in California?
A few trips to Napa. That's about it. L.A. one time with the kids. That's it.
By the way, while we're waiting for Brad real quick to let people know how you ended up here, obviously it was all part of a fundraiser for colorectal cancer, but I assume a cause that's pretty dear to your heart, right?
It is. About 4 years ago, one of my good friends, Brad Hale, an ER doc here in town, died of colorectal cancer at the age of 52. His wife, kids, good friends of ours. And kind of to honor Brad, his wife, Lori, started this doing the local fundraiser for the Blue Hope Bash. And it's been very successful raising money for the Colorectal Cancer Alliance. And I was at that fundraiser last fall, had a few too many drinks, and thought I would bid on this experience.
That's typically how people end up actually interacting with me in any way, shape, or form, right? But listen, it's a great cause. We're happy to have you here, and I know that you had mentioned that you're a Purdue basketball fan. This game in particular with Gonzaga, Jimmy, we talked about it. I think one of the things that is of interest is these two teams saw each other before, but it feels like since then, and I don't mean this as a knock on Purdue. In Purdue's case, they were closer to their ceiling. Ceiling's maybe the wrong word, but they were already playing at a very high level. In Gonzaga's case, maybe younger team feeling their way through and kind of learning on the fly over the course of the year, but Gonzaga has really put things together. I don't think you can necessarily look at that first go-round.
That caveat is an important differentiator that needs to be shared, which is that it's not a fault of Purdue for that. They have been pretty level-headed throughout the entirety of the season. It's why they put together the most wins, I believe, underneath Matt Painter and with their 31st victory just a week ago. But with Gonzaga, they were coming off the heels of no more Drew Timmy, of trying to figure out what their identity was going to be in this new era of more forward-thinking NIL, of still trying to be not just a mid-major program on the WCC, but being a program that is the same blue blood level that Mark Few has carried it into the last 10 to 15 years. And there was a time just 5-6 weeks ago where it looked like they weren't going to be in the field, where it was a true down year for the Bulldogs. And they found themselves in February and into early March, getting all the way to their conference final, losing to St. Mary's, but then going on an impressive run. And what they did to Gonzaga, I don't care that McCullers Jr. was hurt for that game and was unavailable. What they did to Hunter Dickinson and that entire offense to just run them out of the gym in the second half, it's daunting. They're a different team, without question, than what they were when both teams met. That said, I think this is the second This will be the third meeting in the last 16 months that Mark Few has had against Zach Edey, and he's never shown in those matchups an ability to slow him down.
Who does, right?
On that if you're Purdue, because no one does, right? No one has yet to show any inclination of how to slow him down.
I think the thing about Edey and Purdue that is just feels different than years past, Jimmy, is the fact that when Edey was off in the past, you kind of felt like everything slowed down. Whereas now, it feels like if and Zach Edey has not had many off nights, don't get me wrong, but even when he sits, there is an immediate like recoil of what they need to do and a redirection that seems to happen without any sort of a drop off. In other words, and Steve, to your point, Braden Smith's a big part of that, right? I mean, you know, he has a feel for the game that you can't necessarily teach, and just has an awareness. I want to go back to something that you talked about earlier, Steve, with that, because if you look at Braden Smith, he can dictate kind of the pace of where the game is going when the ball's in his hands, right? He's very cerebral in that regard. And you were talking about coaching tennis. In tennis, as a tennis coach, you probably have to see in players a personal discipline to be able to do it. How does one develop, in your opinion, that sort of a discipline or understanding of sport, regardless of sport they're playing?
Well, I mean, it has to start with hard work. I mean, you don't just like walk on the court and all of a sudden have that ability. I mean, what you're seeing with Braden is someone who probably was the first guy in the gym working his tail off. I mean, he's getting down in his defensive stance. He's moving his feet and all that boring stuff. You know, it starts with that. And then with him also, you get the moxie, the attitude, the trash talking, which I think gets him fired up, gets his team fired up. So he, you know, to have that at the point guard position, I think is even more effective, because if you have a, you know, power forward who doesn't touch the ball, doesn't go through him as much, and he has that, you know, it doesn't lift the whole team. But where your point guard is the guy that's doing that, he's going to pick up everybody else's intensity, and I think that's what we see.
And I think what you saw, Jimmy, is that, for example, and even though Edey, like against Utah State, by no means in any way, shape, or form was Edey having an off night, but when he was not on, he didn't necessarily have to even have the on night because of Trey Kaufman-Wren and the ability to get him involved and their offense to then, they had the ability to, instead of their offense funneling right into Edey, to kind of redirect it a little bit. You're going to Kaufman-Wren, that frees up Lawyer, as we've talked about. And then if you are an opponent, Jimmy, trying to figure out how to stop Purdue and slow them down, I mean, you get to a point, do you not, if you're like, what do you do?
And at that point, it's either do you try to dig a little bit deeper, or do you do what Utah State did, which is basically just, you saw a killing on national television. They're fading away in the second half, and it's not even a watchable game if you're a neutral. If you're a Purdue fan, you're going crazy because all this talk about that 8-9 matchup, watch out for it. They pushed it to side like it was a cat swatting at a fly, right? And for Purdue, Zach Edey, yes, he is the, I don't even want to say the straw that stirs the drink, that's Braden Smith, but he is the heartbeat of that offense, sure. But if you're a team that wants to tactically take him away, okay, Trey Kaufman-Wren is going to crash the glass, go get a couple rebounds, extend a possession, have 10, have 12 points a game. And the other thing that isn't being talked about now, Jake, because the focus is a Final Four, the focus is a national championship, Braden Smith, Fletcher Lawyer, Trey Kaufman-Wren, they're all sophomores. Like, yes, right, something's going to happen with this team from an identity standpoint without Edey next year. But you have arguably some of the best backcourt pieces in the country, and they're
and they have a loaded class coming in, right?
Correct. Yes.
Would they have been a tournament team this year without Edey?
That's an excellent question. Boy, that's a really good question.
I think so.
I would say so also.
I would say somewhere in the 5-7 seed line range, but yes, I think so.
I think so, Steve, and I'll tell you why. Because I think at this point, and this is by design, okay? And I've mentioned this before, but several years ago I was at a Purdue practice, and I'm not going to say the name of the player, but there was a prominent player within the state who was a very highly recruited player, and yet Purdue's name wasn't really mentioned with said player. And so I asked, are you recruiting this kid? And they said, well, we kind of backed away because paint, that's that's what they call Painter, didn't feel that he had all of the makeup of exactly what, like, Purdue basketball from the brand of who we want to be. Not that he was a bad guy, but that he might have been more of an individualized player as opposed to a, you know, over totality player, right? And so with that, I think Purdue has done a masterful job of having a program that it isn't necessarily, even though Edie is tremendous, the rest of that roster understands what goes into winning. And if Edie's not there, they just would have redirected at the beginning of the year a different style, and everybody would have equally bought into that style. And then you become more focused probably with Kaufman Wren and Caleb first on the block as opposed to Edie. So, yeah, I think they are still. And I think next year they still will be. I mean, we'll find out next year, right?
Yeah.
Depending on who comes back and whether or not you have attrition. But it just doesn't feel, Jimmy, like a program that has that kind of attrition and turnover, right?
No, it doesn't. I mean, and the fact that each iteration of the big underneath Matt Painter has been better and better and better, whether it's Matt Harms, Isaac Haas, and now to Zach Edey in this creme de la creme final form of a likely two-time national player of the year in Zach Edey. The other thing, and shout out to Purdue and, you know, everybody over at PurdueSports.com for this nugget. I had forgotten about it just because of all the madness of March and because of the state we're in with the Sweet 16. This is effectively the Maui Invitational Part 2 for Purdue, because we know they played Gonzaga earlier this year in that very event. If they face Tennessee in the Elite Eight, if they're fortunate enough to move on and Tennessee takes care of Creighton, that would be another Maui Invitational game. And then if we're really putting the cart before the horse and fast forward in the Final Four, it's Marquette in Phoenix, another team that you faced in November in those three big wins by the Boilermakers to take the Maui Invitational. So it really is fitting that, and this has been the takeaway from the first two rounds of the tournament, I love March Madness. Yes, I too like the upsets, and I would love to see a true non-Power 5 Cinderella like we did last year with FAU still in the dance. But the fact
you don't even have that chance now, right?
The fact of it all is these are all teams, save probably NC State, that ranked inside the top 15, 16 in the country going into the season and going into this tournament. So the fact that it is chalk, I don't think should be the biggest surprise, even in a single elimination tournament, because of the talent that is still out there right now.
Where do we
field.
Get the term chalk?
It's a good question.
Everybody says that, right? Chalk, like, you know, well, is that a tennis term, Steve? It's not a tennis term, right?
No, not unless you're playing on clay.
I guess you're right, right? Yeah, you're right. But you know, everybody goes, well, it just went chalk. Wouldn't it go Sharpie? Isn't that easier to say? Because if the expected team wins, you write it in Sharpie, right? By the way, Eddie, do you happen to have the breaking news sounder? This will be of interest to Steve here. Okay, Steve, we need you to act as the judge and jury.
I also have the chalk origin.
Oh, do you?
Uh-huh.
Tickets now 5 times.
You're at 5X.
I'm at 5X.
Sorry, JMV, you're out.
I bought tickets last night for the Indiana State semifinals at Hinkle, and the value of those tickets on the resale market is now 5 times what I paid. JMV and I are supposed to go.
Well, now what's going to happen is Shannon's going to want to go.
Create the huge curveball, right? So for those that weren't listening earlier, I had mentioned that I bought tickets because I'm like, Shannon, you want to go see Indiana State play at Hinkle? And she was asleep. She's like, yeah, sure, great, whatever. So then I mentioned to John, hey, I bought tickets. Like, if you can't get them, Shannon, I'm sure, will, like, you know, she'll be like, yeah, that's fine. So it was going to be J&B and I going. But now the tickets, the resale market, the tickets are 5 times the value of what I paid for them. Steve, as the new financial analyst here at Aquarian Company, is advising. His advice is that I put them back on the market, right?
We're at a sell stage at this point.
I feel like you also have to include the Sycamore shorts, though, because at this point you're going full turncoat, I think, if you go profit for Prime.
I mean, I'm wearing
you
open the show. Shorts. I should be able to resell, right?
You open the show talking about how I don't care if I'm on the bandwagon. I'm ready to go. Let's roll. Let's roll to Hinkle.
I mean, I think it's great. Like, they were they are fun to watch.
They are.
Now, they do need to figure this out, Indiana State. They do need to figure out which color they're going with, because the baby blues are awesome, but they look kind of weird on the royal blue floor, right?
I would agree.
I mean, you got
to
go one or the
decisions
other. You
got to
make a decision here. Just like Indiana needs to go back to the original single eye in the middle of the court with the state that's way too elongated, right? And Mackey needs to go towards when it used to dim the lights a little bit. kind of like the Joyce Athletic Convention Center does. Okay, so you have the origin of chalk, Jimmy School.
Yeah, I'm disappointed that I forgot about this. The history of chalk dates back to the old days of horse racing, when bookmakers would set the odds for each horse by writing them on a chalkboard at on-track gambling stations. The odds would change during the pre-race betting period, depending on the amount wagered on each horse, so the bookmakers would often need to erase the posted odds and chalk it up with new ones before the beginning of the race.
No, wait a minute.
There you go. Horse racing.
So, but they would use the chalk to change when, like, an upset would happen?
No, when you have, like, a bunch of money coming in on a favorite before the race starts, they would then have to update the odds or chalk it up with new ones.
Gotcha.
They had to constantly change it. So they'd swipe, write the new odds, swipe, write the new odds.
But this would happen when the odds were there because of a favorite, right?
Correct. Yeah. And then if, like, a bunch of betting money comes in and the odds change, they would...
So you know the origin of the term upset, right?
Give me that one.
Steve, do you know the origin of the term upset?
I don't.
Upset was the horse, the only horse to defeat Man of War.
Nice.
The name of the horse was Upset. So, you know, like in a newspaper or whatever, it said like upset defeat, you know, upset victory or whatever it was. And so therefore,
there you go.
Upset is the term that's been used ever since. But I thought last night it's just a brand of basketball that I think that's why people are so on board with this with Indiana State. It's fun. Their coach is fun. I mean, Josh Schertz is fun. I think it's a foregone conclusion with everybody that this is it, right? And I think for Indiana State fans, there's this drama that is surrounding the fact that you feel like this is the window they've got to cash in because it's probably all starting over again next year, right? With probably a lot of new roster, new coach. But they have, and there always is a team, Jimmy, that this is the case. The NCAA tournament selection is an inexact science. And part of the magic of the NCAA selection is the argument of who should be, who was like team number 69 and 70, right? The two teams that should have gotten in. Dick Vitale made a living off of Selection Sunday, going on television and saying, raw deal, Butler, you know, going on and on and on. That's part of the magic of the tournament. And the bubble and everything. It's just like the Indy 500, right? The bounce of the bubble is part of the magic of the draw. But there is always a team that is carrying that flag. But more often than not, it's a team that was a mid-tier team in a big conference. Okay? So you can look on Selection Sunday at the resume of Villanova or Minnesota or, you know, Seton Hall, whatever it might be, and make an argument for them. But at the same time, you're like, yeah, but they get plenty of opportunity to play in the limelight. And Indiana State awakens in people like this underdog story that I think people love, right? And so that I think excites people. And therefore, everybody kind of jumps on board with it.
One nugget on Josh Schertz. This was about a half hour or so ago, nearing an hour ago from Matt Norlander. Real-time update. Louisville was in discussions into this afternoon with Josh Schertz and Pat Kelsey. Pat Kelsey, of course, of College of Charleston, who's reported to take the job. Schertz, whose Indiana State team is still in the NIT, just passed on Louisville. It was a two-horse race. If Kelsey wants the job, it's his. The sides need to negotiate terms. So again, per Matt Norlander, Schertz had the job or was in the conversation for it, passed on it. So Jake, that would leave what? St. Louis is like the only one where maybe he leaves Indiana State? Because otherwise, I don't know what's...
That seems to be kind of the foregone conclusion.
Right, like, I don't know where else you would go that would be a better opportunity than a St. Louis.
St. Louis is paying a lot of money, too, which comes into play. Yeah. Joining us now on the program, with Purdue getting set for the Final Four, he's a guy, of course, that played at Purdue before becoming an Indiana Pacer along his NBA journey from 94 to 98. He was a Boiler, and Brad Miller is out in California. I imagine right outside of Sacramento, Brad, is that correct?
Yeah, it's a little suburb of Sacramento.
Okay, so let's begin with this before we get to basketball. In-N-Out Burger, great or overrated?
It's overrated to me.
Yes! That's what I like to hear.
I'm with Deepak on that one. He says overrated, and I agree with that, too. Like, I'll take a Whataburger out of Texas and Southwest. Now, that one, I really like a Whataburger.
Love that. Whataburger is good because they got barbecue sauce you can put on the side of it. That's the best thing about it.
Yeah, and it's like whatever they season their patties with, it's just plain and simple enough to be like,
Hey, let's begin with this. Purdue in the Sweet 16. And I don't know. I mean, you listen, California is funny to me because when you're living out there, the time difference alone sometimes makes it hard to follow. Do you stay on board with following the Boilers? Have you watched them game by game? Do you just check in and out? What's your level of, I guess, fanaticism for your old school?
I think I missed one game because I forget why, but I watched every game.
Okay.
For one. So basically my ranking in life is to watch Purdue basketball. My fiance knows this. Then we watch Kings basketball. And that's basically the two loves right there.
Life's simple. I like that. And then you got a bunch of land. I know that. But, okay, let's begin with this. Your level of concern with Gonzaga, you were a player, so tell me this. When you play a team that you had beaten earlier in the year, is that advantage, disadvantage, or you throw it out the window?
I mean, you almost throw it out the window because, I mean, Gonzaga's a way better team. You know, now than what they were there. I mean, they're younger than what we are. So, you know, watching them play against, I mean, Kansas the other day, it was like, all right, they look a lot better than what they did there, confident-wise. So, you know, it's going to be a battle. There's no doubt. I mean, it's a matter of how many fouls can Edie draw against all those guys, and that's kind of the game plan as always, I would think.
Brad, which of the following has impressed you more over – this span of time, and both are credit to Matt Painter and his ability to develop players and get the most out of guys. But would you give the nod to Braden Smith's transformation freshman year to sophomore year, or the totality of growth over a 4-year span of Zach Edey?
Oh, Zach Edey. I mean, the jump from sophomore year to last year, his junior was just, you know, obviously he was split minutes with Travion, you know, his first 2 years, who there's a good reason why, because he was a beast of a player. But, you know, just all of his strides, like when I started watching last year, it was like, crap, look at his footwork. Like that little spin was way better because it was just always left shoulder. Now he added his little drop step to go over his right shoulder with the finish with the left or finish with a two-hand dunk usually. But, you know, he added his good counter move last year, and that's what impressed me. Was to see that the counter move, and obviously Brandon Brantley's been working his butt off with him, my old teammate. So, I mean, his strides, just skill-wise, was amazing to see sophomore to junior, and he's just gotten even better this year.
Brad, it's almost, we were talking about this earlier, Brad Miller, the former Boiler great, is our guest. Edey has been so good that it's overshadowed probably at times the high level of play that have come, you know, around him, right? I mean, everybody from Braden Smith, the lawyer, you know, obviously the names of all of them. But who is the guy that you look at and you say, that guy along with Edey has elevated his game to the point that is really carrying Purdue, and if they want to get to the promised land, he needs to maintain it at the level that he's played. That player not named Zach Edey is which?
Well, I mean, I can go with Trey Kaufman, right? And the way he just dominated this last game because it put so much pressure on Edey, and then he's just a man-child down there. You know, and obviously Lance Jones has been huge for us. He added, you know, experience at the guards, which kind of guess last year with all of our guards were pretty much, you know, all the freshman lawyer and Smith last year, and you had a guy like Lance Jones, you know, Purdue's not a big transfer portal type of school, but, man, they found the right guy there that fits exactly what they want. I mean, even got Coach Katie out there dancing, doing the Lance Jones dance. Every time I see a video, I just keep laughing. I watch it over and over, Coach trying to do the Lance Jones out there before the tournament game.
Brad Miller is our guest who is out in Sacramento talking about Purdue and Gonzaga. Brad, I want to get back to real quick your comments on Zach Edey and take it a little bit further. There has been so much discussion, and I think you'd be a really good person to ask, about whether or not Edey can be a long-term NBA player. I know that he doesn't have the up-and-down floor speed that the game is played in the NBA, but in the half court, he obviously can do some pretty dangerous things. You played in the league. It's changed a little bit since then, perhaps, but Zach Edey, long-term NBA guy or no?
Yeah. Yes, because there's also one things, you know, like, well, I know this. If you look at my game in the NBA and you look at my game in Purdue, they're pretty much not even close to the same type of game of what, you know, the way I adjusted my game and what I could do, you know. And I heard Edey make a comment. He's like, I'm doing what Purdue needs me to do. He's like, I got more in my bag. kind of deal. And I remember, like, the IU game when he banked in that three-pointer, I was like, oh, shit, he really wants to shoot this three. Like, when he set the first pick and then he re-picked and caught it, picked and popped and just, you know, he banked it in, but it went in for his first three. But, you know, there's a lot of things like his game, I'm sure, when you get in the NBA, you will adjust. I mean, there's no reason for him to try to shoot jumpers, you know, in college right now. Like, he is the most dominant player that has come through college basketball in 20, 30 years, you know, as a college, at the college level. You know, there's not one person that can match up with him. Even maybe Big Slim down in North Carolina State might be able to put some body on him down there. But, you know, there's just nobody that can compete with his size. And I was talking with one of my friends that's an assistant coach with the Denver Nuggets after a game against the Kings, and we got talking about Edie. He goes, he's slow. I go, Joker's slow as shit, too. He goes, good point. I'm like, Joker is probably the slowest person in the NBA, but he's also a two-time MVP. Not saying he's like that, but I'm saying there's a way, and I've been pitching him for 2 years. My friend that works for the Spurs and the friend at the Nuggets, I was like, you guys get him. I mean, imagine Wemba and Edie. You got 7-4, 7-4 starting. Wemba can collect everything. Edie just has to funnel him. You know, I mean, there's...
Yeah, he can facilitate, right? I mean, he can facilitate like Jokic does.
Yeah, I mean, his passing game impressed me. So obviously, I like to pass. So, you know, he's been seeing all the doubles all year, and he's really impressed me on his, you know, passing the turnover. It's not really assist the turnover. It's like, I call it passing the turnover ratio. When he gets double, he's not really turning over. He's getting the ball out of there and, you know, giving him the option to move it. So, man, he's got a lot of skill, and, you know, I think he's going to surprise people. You know, Purdue Bays get overlooked going in the NBA. They think that's all we do is, you know, grinding the paint. So my agent represents Edie as well, so I know he's in good hands in terms of that when it comes time for all the NBA stuff.
Brad, when you were a player in the tournament, and maybe this is different from one player to the next, Brad Miller, our guest, the stakes are obviously very high right now, and for Purdue, there are demons they're trying to exorcise, especially from last year. Maybe that took place by getting out of round one. But are you concerned at all about how this particular roster or Matt Painter guides this roster through the pressures that now increase with each level of the NCAA tournament?
I mean, I've been there, done that, you know. I was almost part of the first number one team to lose to Western Carolina my sophomore year. So I've been there as the number one, almost lost it. You know, luckily Virginia took that for us at first, so we weren't the first. But, you know, I think these guys have had a different focus all year. You kind of see it. I mean, they looked a little wore down. By the time last year tournament, obviously just came in looked way too confident. And, you know, those smaller schools kind of give Purdue more problems than the bigger schools, really, because it's like you run a bigger lineup traditionally. Like Gonzaga's got big, so it's going to not be like a, you know, a 6'6 guy out there guarding Edie that decides to hit a career high 5 threes in a game. You know, and he's hit 2 all year. So, you know, now they're in the teams that they should match up, you know, talent wise and physically wise. And, you know, trust me, I'm nervous as shit, and I'm excited as shit, too, for these games coming up.
Well, Brad, I'll tell you what. Here's the deal. I want you to get, and not In-N-Out because it's overrated, get some Whataburger, have it flown in, and if the Boilers get to the Final Four, I'm committing you right now. If the Boilers get to the Final Four, you're coming back on the show.
Trust me. They go to the Final Four, I got a place down in Phoenix, so it's a – quick, easy flight from Sacramento, I'll tell you that.
That'd be the biggest party in the desert, man.
Oh, man, that'll be a lot of Boilermaker shots, probably. The beer and shot Boilermaker.
Brad Miller, Purdue great, 94-98, two-time All-Star as well for the Indiana Pacers. Brad, we appreciate it, man. Enjoy life out in Cali, and we will talk to you when the Boilers get to Arizona.
Let's do it. Boiler up.
All right, appreciate it. Brad Miller, the Purdue great. And Eddie had his finger actively on that mute button, right? Eddie, did you give it a workout?
Oh, yeah.
All right. Robbie Hummel going to join us next.
The Laundry Room. For as long as I...
entire commercial break sanitizing the microphone after the dump buttons. I'm saying, and he doesn't follow what I'm saying.
I follow what you're saying.
Why would I have to sanitize the mics? None of the mics said it.
Or because the
absorbed those
the potty words.
Words
went through them. You play along.
No.
Okay. Joining us now on the program, Robbie Hummel. Of course, another Purdue great who has been on the call for the NCAA tournament. You see him in television on a variety of different networks, and including Big Ten Network, notably during the regular season. But, Robbie, I'll begin with this. You know, the obvious question here is going to be about Purdue, but we have focused so much on the Boilers. I'm curious from your perspective, the team right now in the Sweet 16 that is playing at its highest level that it probably can play to get to this point, that is getting the most out of itself, is which?
Purdue won their two games by 33 points a game. That's a pretty good place to start for them. Illinois was impressive. UConn has been impressive. I didn't get to the one downside of doing the NCAA tournament, whether it's for TV or for radio, is that you don't get to watch necessarily nearly as much as I would as when I was a kid, or if I was just a fan. You know, you're so locked in to the games that you're doing. I was out in Spokane, so I saw Alabama win. I saw San Diego State win out of those two pods or whatever you'd call it. So they wouldn't fall into those categories. So I'll go with UConn, Purdue, Illinois. I think those three teams are playing really well right now.
Robbie, I've asked you this before in different variations over the course of this season, and I've asked this to a couple other Purdue alums as well over this run for the Boilermakers. So if they win it all, the conversation's a moot point. But at this stage, matched up against Gonzaga on the doorstep of a second Elite Eight appearance in five seasons, is this the best collection Purdue's ever put together?
Ever, you know, I guess if you're comparing it to some of Gene Katie's teams, you could probably debate that. But the stretch run that Purdue has kind of been on, I think that this is probably Matt Painter's best team. You know, I don't know. And I was on a team that was really good, and I'm probably biased to that team. But I think we would have a hell of a time with Zach Edey. I don't know how we would guard him. And I love Lewis Jackson. He's a really good player that I played with. Great point guard, but Braden Smith is an All-American level player. So I think that we would have a hard time with this group. Edie would have to guard Juwan Johnson out on the perimeter, but with that being said, we would have no answer for his size or physicality. So it's an unbelievable job that Matt Painter has done, and I really can feel the focus and kind of the demeanor of this team as they have looked to maybe kind of erase what happened last year and write a new story.
Robbie, to me, and I want you to expand on this, Robbie Hummel, our guest, obviously, Edey, just you talked about, his size, his physicality, he probably doesn't get enough credit for his down-low footwork and his touch, but does that alone is hard enough to guard. If Trey Kaufman ran on the opposite side of him as being offensively active, does that literally make Purdue 100% unguardable? What do teams do if Kaufman Wren is continuing the level that he was at against Utah State?
Yeah, I mean, he was phenomenal. Starting, I guess, with Edey, you know, I'm just blown away that someone could be the National Player of the Year and is going to repeat. And there are people that legitimately cover the sport that think he's just tall. And I guess to me that just means that you have no idea what you're talking about. I mean, that is the dumbest thing I've ever heard. I've played with plenty of seven-footers that either hate playing or average 2 points and one rebound, or I was even watching some stuff for Gonzaga, and it was a team that they had played earlier in the year. I was going through some clips for their guys because I'm doing the games up in Detroit for Westwood One Radio, and there was a seven-footer that they were playing. And to watch this guy try to defend, to stop the basketball, turn, contest a shot, and then land and try to change ends, he was like a glacier. And Edey does that for 34 minutes. You know, it truly is amazing. But getting to Kaufman Wren, he kind of did this against Illinois back in January where he went for 20-plus and was active. He can score the ball. You know, there is no doubt about that. And I think next year when Edey's gone, you'll see a lot of him scoring the basketball inside. the fit isn't always ideal. You know, I think Mason Gillis probably is the better fit because of the way that he can throw the ball in the post and the way that he spreads the floor from three. But if Kaufman Wren's going to do that still on the offensive glass, you know, we know he can score with his right hand. It's amazing. He reminds me of Luis Scola with the way that he'll pivot and pivot and pivot and get back to his right, and no one can really guard it. He's a good player, and I think that it's just been maybe a little hard for him because at times there's not a ton of space down there on the block because of the gravity that Zach plays with. But no question, when he's on the offensive boards and he's looking for his offense, and they're not going to run a ton of plays for him. They do start games giving him a touch to try to get him going early. But, yeah, if he can do that, Purdue is going to be a really, really tough guard.
What makes Gonzaga, if anything, a different team than the one that Purdue saw earlier this year?
Yeah, they've been really good offensively since they moved Ben Gregg into the starting lineup. And, you know, you look at their personnel, they are going to put Purdue in ball screen after ball screen after ball screen. They did it to Kansas, and with Ryan Nemhard and Nolan Hickman, those guys are going to get their games on. You've got a couple guys. Braden Huff can pick and pop. You know, he's one of their bigs. I mentioned Ben Gregg. He's looking to shoot threes. Graham Ike is more of a traditional kind of back to the basket lefty that's going to look to play inside. And I think he's taking 15 threes on the year. But their bigs can shoot. It'll be a ton of pick and roll. And, you know, the one thing you asked for the differences, but the one thing that Gonzaga did do well down in Maui was they did rebound with Purdue. I think they were +5 on the offensive glass. And they evened him up overall. So that'll be a huge thing. But to me, the biggest thing in this game for Purdue is how they guard pick and roll.
Robbie, I want to ask you about the officiating regarding Edie. It seems like he's doing a better job this year of, you know, avoiding foul trouble. Do you think he's getting a more favorable whistle just due to his more respect for him? Or has he kind of changed his game to kind of stay out of that type of situation?
Well, the first thing I would say is that the better players in the Big Ten, I've always felt like, have gotten a better whistle. You know, like Jared Sullinger got calls. Evan Turner got calls. And you'd certainly earn that over the time that you play. You know, I think he's hard to officiate. I've watched Big Ten games where I've gotten done watching the game, and I'm like, what did we just watch? And I've been fortunate to do some Big East games this year. And, you know, teams like Creighton and Marquette and Xavier want to play fast, and they don't foul. And it's like, wow, this is like watching a different sport. You know, there are plays where I've seen fouls called, and you're watching, you're like, man, I don't know if that's a foul on Edie or if that's a foul on the defense, because they're really both doing crazy stuff. So I think he's a challenge to officiate. Whether he's gotten a more favorable whistle, I don't think so. I mean, I think he gets fouled a ton. I think that with his size and physicality, you know, there's a lot of defenders who would say, man, he's fouling me. So I don't really put much into that. I know that that's been a big talking point amongst all Big Ten fans out there. But, you know, it's one of those deals where as long as I can remember playing, the good players in the Big Ten have gotten calls. That's just the way it is.
Purdue great and college basketball analyst Robbie Hummel is our guest. Robbie, if you're putting the Purdue hat on as an alum, as a player that was underneath Coach Painter, that, you know, we always talk about what ifs with your group, and for this group to now have an opportunity for every Purdue Boilermaker to be, not that you weren't proud of it to begin with, but to have an opportunity to punch a ticket to the Final Four, get there, make some noise. It's certainly not an easier path because you still have Gonzaga, Creighton, Tennessee, and that's just in the Midwest region alone. But what about this year, if anything, from the alum standpoint, feels different?
Well, I'm just really proud of this team. You know, every time I watch them play, they compete, they do it with class, they play hard, they play for each other. You know, I think when you're a former player, those are the things that you want your school to do. You want your team to play the right way. And those dudes go out there every night, and they do that. So I'm proud to watch them play. And, you know, there's a lot of people that have played at Purdue that are really excited for this weekend because there's been just so many opportunities that have gone awry or some of the injuries that you mentioned. You know, those are hard pills to swallow. I think the hardest thing for me when I look back at when I was a player is that, man, we didn't even get a chance. You know, I blow my knee out in late February and that team is rolling. And, you know, the hardest thing is to say, man, maybe we would have won. You know, you almost rather lose because then at least you know you got to go out there and do it. So I love watching this team play. You know, to get to see Coach Painter kind of evolve from when I played for him, where he's an up and coming, really young, really hungry head coach who's trying to set the tone, trying to build a culture. And you think about when you're I'm now 35. I think he got the job when he was like 36 or 37. And to get that type of opportunity at a Big Ten school where you played, you know, he was definitely, I think he challenged us. But at the same time, when you get something like that, man, you've got to hang on for dear life. And to see him evolve now to be one of the really, really great coaches in college basketball is a joy to watch. It's a big weekend for Purdue. I think that everybody understands that, but I think that this team is built for that. They certainly are. That doesn't mean that they'll win, but they will certainly give a great effort and go out there and give it their all.
Robbie, I want you to hold your breath because I'm going to leave you with a listener comment that was just texted to me about Robbie Hummel. You ready? I'm going to pass this along to you.
I'm ready.
Jake, I'm a diehard IU fan. I love Indiana, and I don't like Purdue. Robbie Hummel is the best commentator in college basketball. There you go.
That's very nice of him to say. I will say, this year doing games in Indiana was a little bit of a bizarre world where people were so nice to me. Or it would always be you'd walk in there and my first game there. I don't know if I've told you
this
guys
story.
This story
is great. I've heard you tell it before.
Oh, have I? I mean,
not to Jake, though. Go again. Tell it again.
Okay. Well, yeah, the first game it was Northwestern, Indiana. Romeo Langford ended up making a game go-ahead shot to win the game. And I was just sitting there. I'm a little bit nervous because I haven't been back there since I was a player. And I'm just sitting there reading my notes, and this, like, 80-year-old gentleman comes up from behind me and taps me on the shoulder. I take my headset off. I look at him. And he goes, man, it's a disgrace that they're going to let you call a game on this floor. And I thought he was kidding. So I was like, well, you know, I'm just here to do my job. And he pointed at the top of Assembly Hall, and he goes, man, they should make you call this thing from up there. And just walked away. He was so disgusted that I was there. But those have become fewer and far between. So the people in Bloomington have been very nice to me.
That either means that people in Indiana have become softened by, you know, the way things are going, or you're old.
I'm old as hell. I don't remember.
That's right.
Time is undefeated. They might not be here either. Who knows?
The 80-year-old remembers, trust me.
Oh, he did remember. He did remember. He'll never forget.
Robbie, we appreciate it, man. Always enjoy the conversation. Appreciate the time.
No problem. Thanks, guys.
All right, Robbie Hummel, our guest. We'll come back. We'll hand it off to John. We'll check in on the ticket prices, and we'll get Steve's final verdict whether or not John's going to the game with me or not next.
Luxair is the intelligent way to keep your home.
This is me, all right? I'm not a athlete. This is my way. This is how I win.
Just two plays for you on an NBA Wednesday. We will take the Orlando Magic to win on the money line over the Golden State Warriors. Later tonight, give me the Pacers outright on the money line against the Chicago Bulls.
So Utah, are they playing tonight, by the way?
The Jazz?
Well, here's the only reason I ask. I don't really care if the Jazz play, but the Blues are going to be played right now because Steve Wagner, who came in today, again, all part of the Blue Hope Bash, which raised money for colorectal cancer in honor of your friend, Steve. Brad Hale. And so you, back when you were teaching tennis, you had a guy that said, I'll teach you tennis in exchange for teaching you harmonica, right?
Yes.
So you're going to play us. Give us what we're going to play.
I got a short blues song I wrote in 1 minute downstairs while I was waiting to come in today. You ready for this?
Beautiful. All right. Here we go.
I'm sitting here with Jake Query, the king of the analogy, urging people to get screened, to get their colonoscopy. Ooh, I'm singing the Innis Sports Talk Blues. And if Ballard don't sign a free agent, if he don't pull out his wallet and make a payment, then I'll be singing the Colts Blues too.
Outstanding.
Well done.
Outstanding. And JMV, by the way, may not be having the Blues on Tuesday because the price is now starting to drop a little bit. So we're back under the 5X, right?
All right. Friendship trumps money then.
Well, co-workers, right? No, we kid. Steve, I appreciate it, man. And certainly thanks for raising the money for everything that goes in honor of your friend and fighting out colorectal cancer and that important reminder for everybody as well. John is in next, and we will be back with you at noon tomorrow. Thanks for listening to Query & Company.
The Ride with JMV.
Bobby Riddell joins us. Is Purdue getting an